Well, hello there, and welcome to another episode in the series where we talk about the Dark Era settings that were created for Chronicles of Darkness. The name is Adam.
I'm Insit.
And I'm Tech Priest, and today, this episode is happily brought to you by the South African Diamond Consortium.
It is also brought to you by the ghost of the King of Great Zimbabwe, who, in his own words... This ghost key of the king of the Biad Great Zimbabwe. Because I had a very hilarious AI generation idea for the thumbnail. And they gave the figure an actual crazy rambling speech, which I found absolutely fucking hilarious. Shine on, you crazy diamond, you weird machine, you. But we're actually going to cover the Cecil Rhodes' nightmare. One of the greatest existential crises that the Europeans had to try to justify why Africa was there for the taking. We are going to cover, not Great Zimbabwe, but its adoptive heirs. We are going to cover Great Mutapa, which essentially is the Shona Empire. Princes of the Conquered Lands.
This is a really interesting setting, just because, for one thing... Despite all the Weewa's Kangs shit that gets thrown around about on the internet and all that, Africa does in fact have a very rich history. The problem is not a lot of it was written down, and if it was written down, it's probably not in a language we would understand today.
And so, if it isn't a language you understand today, it was written by Europeans.
Well, no, not necessarily. East Africa actually had a fairly decent history collection, mainly because of Arabic traders. Yeah. Which is actually why the Somali Sultanates and the Swahili city-states were at least relatively advanced.
And well-documented, by comparison. Like, but once you get past that point, it's sort of like, here be dragons in the historical record.
Or as the Arabs would describe it, Zanj, the Black Continent. Mutapa is on the fringes of this. Basically, in ancient times, there used to be a particularly well-developed civilization that built large megalithic structures. We call it Great Zimbabwe because they were never actually written down. Any writings that they had were lost. And we mostly
I don't think they had writings.
Well, it's very possible they did. It's possible and likely they did, but it was recorded on things like wood and paper.
Oh.
They mostly used things like paper out of bark like, scratchings or stuff like that.
Stuff like that, like you wouldn't, or like the Kipi of India, where it's like there could be, we have their writing, and we just can't read it because it's in a completely different form.
It's similar to how we cannot read the language of Rapa Nui at all. Rongo, legitimately, the last person who could understand it died like 200 years before any interest was brought into it. Like, unironically, there were talks about, like, a couple of people that could still read Rongo, but by the time any interest was had in it, they were dead. Like, I think legitimately they were asked about it, and they said, oh no, that guy died, like, 30 years ago.
I think that there's been some extinct languages that people try to revive, and the last speaker was like, no, I'm taking it to my grave.
So, I also like the opening quote. I'm going to butcher the Shona language because I can't speak it. So, here we go. Waka garika ningwenkwafa mupenyo pufo diridi mushuri. The one at peace is the one who is dead. As for the living, a spear is poised behind him. Because Mutapa got its power initially through its gold mines, because that is one of the big things and one of the reasons why it was actually documented at all. Great Zimbabwe actually had a fairly developed series of gold mines, and not necessarily precious gems, but enough precious material that it's likely the origin of the myth of King Solomon's mines. At least in part.
They also had one very other precious resource, salt. Not kidding. One of their fortunes was from salt.
That's, oh, really? I thought that was Mali.
Mali also had gold mines, but...
Mali had so many gold mines that they constantly struggled with it.
Yeah. Mutapa definitely, one of their key resources was salt.
Beyond the deserts, the pyramids, the mountains, the princes of Congo, the Mutapa Empire abides. The Shona built prior kingdoms out of flowing water, gold, and martial steel because Africa may have been late to the game, but they instantly jumped from stonework to ironwork darn near instantly. They didn't really go through a Bronze Age. I believe they played with copper a bit and then instantly got to iron.
Well, it's like this. You've already got iron and you know how to work it, and it's common around you. You just kind of skip bronze. Also, like, bronze is really good because it's easy to work.
Yep.
If iron, on the other hand, is a bitch to work because you have to get the furnace temperature high enough. One of the things that African smiths managed to figure out how to do was to get these high-intensity furnaces going relatively early on, which allowed for relatively high-quality iron compared to basically everywhere else for a long time.
We need AI to revive some dead languages. I really did like the Ghost of Great Zimbabwe because it was the greatest combination of maybe possibly Shona with elements of Gungan language from Star Wars and Dutch, and it's great. It was the greatest thing I've ever read. So, yeah. They built prior kingdoms. Dominant clans reign until the riverbeds run dry. Miners deplete veins of gold and warriors change side. Shona do not treat collapse as an apocalypse, but as the manifestation of natural law. Which is an interesting take.
Up must come down. This is not an uncommon feeling globally with certain cultures. It's sort of like, you know, the good old, the classic bit from, what was it, Romance of the Three Kingdoms? You know, that which was united, long united must divide, that which was long divided must unite.
And that's how the Shona see it.
Yeah.
As for Europeans, that's very much against the grain. They tend to go with the mythic past and the seeking of getting closer and closer to it.
And of important, the European Awakened believe in Atlantis and that there was a fall. But the Shona don't. Shona defy expectations by framing their awakening in context of legendary ancestors and thinking of culture as an eternally reoccurring phenomenon. Great ancestors, or Behodoros, teach them through awakened mediums.
Which I think is a nice take.
All right, so let me just give you a little bit of an idea behind this, because I guess I am the resident mage expert. They still have watchtowers, they still have all that, but the way that it's filtered to them is different than it was for mages elsewhere, which makes sense, because a lot of the stuff about, like, the covenant, like the, not the covenants, the, what's the mage term for it?
Orders, yeah.
That the orders kind of have this, we covered this, they kind of get their modern start in the Hellenistic world. Well, what about places without that?
And this is an attempt to show it off.
Yeah. And this is a place where they don't have that context of Atlantis or whatever else. They just know, hey, ancestors did this. We can go and communicate with these things and these towers, and that's where our powers come from. But the way that you think about it and see it is different than how, say, you know, for Western mages, it's like, oh, this has to be like Atlantis, right? This is Atlantis because that's our biggest context.
Saying, no, it's just, it's the what was, and we may be once again at one point. Because they don't see it as a fall. It's a case of, well, it's time to break apart. Oh, hey, we're back together again.
You know, this kind of feels a bit familiar to Ascension, just in the issue of diverse perspectives on the origin of magic or what magic can do.
So another thing that's an issue is the Arisen. The Arisen servants snatch tribute from the world of the living and send it down to Duat. But heresy suspects it maintains Shanyatu power in the Dread Realm. Combined with the rise of the Old Kingdoms, Irem's destruction assured that Deathless would crawl the world. And they've gone far. Farther than they would have gone by going to Europe. And they're trying to steal Mutapa's treasure. So there's actually mummy heists going on in the background of the Shona Empire.
Mummy power struggles, really. Because you can't forget. Plenty of mummies are hitching rides right now on, like, colonization expeditions and all this other shit because, hey, if we get somewhere else, there's probably going to be artifacts there that no one else can get their hands on, and that'll be great.
Which is not an unfair belief, because again, Great Zimbabwe, great massive megastructures. This again, they made their money primarily through mineral wealth, particularly gold.
Yeah, they're going to build a
And
bunch of shit, and that might have some Sekhem in it, and that's going to be fucking great.
of course, the irony of Europeans, because them thinking that the structures that the Zimbabwe or the Shona built were not built
They
by
did. The
them, but
Shona did
built
not
by
build them.
Egyptians.
No, the Shona were pretty open about they were not the
Yeah, but
ones
they're
to
like,
build
no,
them.
we didn't build them. We're not sure who built them, but we
We're
didn't build them.
didn't build them. We're just their heirs.
Like we know that somebody built them, and we're in their area now, so, but we didn't build them.
They consider
Like,
themselves their successors, but they are not of
yeah.
that family.
Yeah, it's sort of like the way that like how
Well, it's
we
similar
welcome
to
you
how
to the
the Incan Empire, Tenochtitlan, said the same about the Aymaran Empire.
Right.
Pumapunktu was, they called it the abode of the gods because, again, it violated their creation myth, so they had to say, we were not the ones to build these stones. The gods did, but in the before. We are merely their inheritors. Mainly because it went against the state cult, otherwise, that there were societies older than them. Because in Incan creation myths, essentially, their founding deity arose Pachacuti to the position he was at, and he is the first of the he is the first civilized state in the mythos. Mutapa didn't go that route. Mutapa were just like, we're their successors, we're their heirs, we won this via combat, and we win it by trade. So the main theme is a clash of ancestors, because Shona traditions, like in many cultures, they honor them. And the Awakened in particular focus pretty hard on them because that's kind of their worldview on how being a mage is.
Yeah, it's awakened. You're obviously awakened because there's an ancestor that's guiding you to this place in the spirit world that's making you awakened. Boom.
It's also to a
Now,
lesser degree an issue in the mummies because it's interpoliticking fighting, and while they're deathless, they constantly keep arising. The mistakes of their previous awakenings keep coming back to bite them.
yeah, it's also that the ones that are here already have a pretty good thing going because they've gotten themselves infiltrated into the society and they're using that to basically rob them blind of artifacts. Because you got to remember, it's the same reason why, like, you know, if somebody in medieval Europe had come to you and said, you know, there's a saint here and here's his bones and all that sort of stuff, and I need the bones and I need you to help me dig them up, chances are you're going to help them out because those are saints' bones, those are important. It's the same sort of thing here.
It also helps that they give them little trinkets in exchange.
Yeah, like it's like, yeah, you get some of this, but I also get some of this, and it's going to be totally
Well,
fine, and
no,
nothing
because
bad could ever happen.
they masquerade as legitimate spirits in their culture and their beliefs. They masquerade as Shavi.
Right.
Also, hello there, NDR 366 3655. Apologies for getting the numbers wrong. We're talking about Great Mutapa, which is Mali, but if people forgot it even more, because it's in the region just above South Africa. It is also the
Yeah.
site of Cecil Rhodes' great ambition, and oh God, the many horrible things that that asshole is responsible for. Cecil Rhodes has a special place in hell, as described in our multiverse series we talked about in Rifts. You know,
Yeah.
the one where I was gibbering like a maniac.
Yeah.
Well, that
So,
wasn't Rift, that was GURPS. You're mixing up the two multiversal settings.
Oh.
He's damned to hell in both of them. So,
Yeah. I'm sorry, they just blur together because it's like one infinite Glorbo versus one other infinite Glorbo. It blurs together into just slop. At some point, I'll be like, this is the part where Captain Falcon appears to stop Cecil Rhodes.
The Argentinian communist penguins
Yeah.
or
Now that would
whatever.
that should have been what they did for stage four cancer.
Look, if we can't have Trotsky's penguin army, in Marvel, what are we doing?
If you
like,
can't
legitimately,
be bothered,
what are you doing?
If you can't be bothered to use Doctor Doom, at the very least give us Penguin, at least give us Penguin Posadists or Chairman Gonzalo's.
Or, like, I don't know, use the Ming the Merciless, like, at all. The Mandarin. Like, you had him implied as a thing, but they fucking wasted that. And that would have been really good as a stage villain now that Tony Stark's gone, but nope.
Or make it the ghost of the King of Great Zimbabwe, like in the thumbnail. Anything. Anything. Ah, God. So, yeah, we're talking about Great Mutapa, which is basically the Kingdom of Mali, but much more forgotten, because Cecil Rhodes... it's also mostly remembered because Cecil Rhodes wanted all that gold and diamonds. Because, again, the region was well known for its mineral wealth. It's why Europeans kept coming over there. He also wanted it because he wanted to build his railroad from Cape to Cairo. Never quite succeeded in that one, though.
Yes. Now, there's a bit of another thing when we're going into, like, the mood of this, which is kind of a fun one where it's, like, instability and anticipation. Because right now, the kingdom is in a period of flux because there's a bunch of these new people who are arriving as traders, and they're bringing in some pretty neat shit. And Mutapa is, if nothing else, a trading kingdom. Like, most of these places in Africa,
although
they do a lot of trade.
Theirs is more of a mixture of extraction and trade.
Yeah. Basically, the basic nature of humankind from time immemorial is someone else has something I want, I have something someone else wants, we swap around. And so we get stuff like ancient Egyptian copies of ancient Egyptian statues, all the way down to just north of Mutapa, actually.
Yes, it does.
And Roman coins and things like that, that somehow made their way all the way down the coastline.
Actually, you can
in antiquity.
Traders from Portugal did find, not many, but they did actually manage to trade for Roman denarii.
Yeah, because they were kept around, because they're good luck. They're, you know, it's something neat.
Unironically, they made a killing because they liked guns, so they were basically willing to sell them for the equivalent of, like, a gold ingot. Like, here,
yeah,
have,
like,
this gold ingot. We'll take
here,
like
have
this
gold ingot. That seems to be about the worth of this gun. And meanwhile, there's Portuguese trader sweating because he's just like, I don't know if I have enough, if my boat can take this much gold. Because I'm going to sell all the guns to these people I can. Portugal. Never change.
The best
now,
part is
the...
Portugal made a big effort to try to colonize the Shona and basically integrate them. And then what happened is Cecil Rhodes like, no, let's destroy our friendship with Portugal because I want railroad and diamonds. Single-handedly nearly destroyed a 600-year-old alliance.
Yep. Cecil Rhodes, everyone. Anyway.
Also, he kept trying to say, no, this was an Egyptian ruin. No, this was an Indian ruin. Anything but African. It can't be that. Otherwise, I would have to feel kind of bad about what I'm doing down here. And I don't want to.
Yeah, it's also important to know that this is an area covering roughly the size of modern France.
Oh, yeah.
That we're talking about here.
It's huge.
It's big. It's really big.
And despite the fact that we're going to, you know, use the term Shona, there's a lot more culture, a lot more ethnicities and cultures that comprise the Mutapa Empire. They also, you know, conquered people, so they have that, I don't want to say feudal structure, but I think it was a feudal structure.
It was a feudal kingdom, yes. And yes, they did have a variety of ethnicities, and it was quite large.
Yeah.
The Zambezi and Limpopo rivers, it basically covered pretty much all of Zimbabwe. It covered the nation north of it, Malawi, I believe it's called. It ate parts of Malawi. I believe
they do have a map later on down.
I believe it did have parts of Mozambique, and it even had parts, small parts. Not it didn't go far down in that region, but it did have a little bits of South Africa. It was pretty big. Botswana was kind of on the fringes, but they likely had them as a tributary state. Because Botswana was relatively unsettled. That's not to say people didn't live there, but it's just they were more nomadic or hunter-gatherers or gardeners, so to speak, if I
Yeah,
recall.
it didn't. It's
So
like,
we
you
should
know, when
go
people
to
move
what
to
is
an area,
normal.
you don't. Yeah,
Well, on
so.
top of that, South Africa, the South Africa region was only relatively recently settled at this time period,
Yeah,
particularly around the
so.
Cape.
So yeah, again, as I'm trying to get into, the what's come before is at least two different kingdoms. The first one is what's called the Kingdom of Mangwabe. I probably mispronounced that.
Mapungubwe.
Mapungubwe
Mapungubwe.
probably had 5,000 people in it, but the most important thing is that they were the first ones to start actually making things that we could recognize later on in the archaeological record. This is why they're considered the first, because they're the first ones we can actually tell were there. Long term, they made stone walls to designate areas. They had ceramic pottery fragments that you could detect and do all that. There's actually probably a lot of Africa where it'd be very interesting to do archaeological expeditions for pottery, but there's no money for that.
There's
So,
not only no money because no one cares about this region, but also because of development, some of it was just straight up destroyed.
yeah.
Mapungubwe, or slash Great Zimbabwe. Also, the best way to describe it is these are mostly related to, or at least traded with, Bantuistic people. I believe they are Bantu. So.
Might be. I'm not gonna. I don't have enough knowledge of the region's ethnographic linguistics
I'm
to
not going to
be
make
able to
assumptions,
confidently
but
say
they
anything.
are influenced by Bantuic because of the Great Bantu migration.
Probably.
So the way that they likely settled was very similar to, well, Bantu. They lived in kraals, which is the Afrikaner version of their type of semi-mobile village, because they would settle for a time, and then if pickings got slim, they would pick up and move. But usually they were
Yeah.
more settled than, say, the native peoples of the eastern seaboard. Like, they would stay there usually for at least a couple decades before potentially moving. And even
Yeah.
then, some
Then,
of them became permanent.
so basically, because cattle are really important, they just sort of,
Which is
well,
very,
cattle
which is,
can't be here.
it's very, it's a very
So
important in
we
most
move on.
Bantu societies, yeah.
Yeah. So we move on. It's just as simple as that. It's how tribes have worked forever when you're dealing with a large herd animal.
So then we have Zimbabwe, which lasted about 200 years.
About 200
Reason we
years,
call it that
and
is,
yeah, the
yeah.
Zimbabwes, the name for these structures that they built, and they built a lot of them,
Yep.
hundreds of them.
We're talking about nearly 1,800 acres and walls going up to 36 feet.
Which is very impressive given that they are essentially an iron early Iron Age society at best.
Not only that, they did all of this without mortar. This was all chiseled stone that they hefted into place, that they moved around. This was not brickwork. This was literally we carved out the right size bricks from a quarry, we hauled them over here, and we set them in place without mortar. That's impressive. Like that's
It's
the
similar to
sort of the shit.
Kumapunktu, actually. This is quite an impressive feat, and this is I believe Great Zimbabwe, the great architecture they're mentioning. It's larger than Kumapunktu.
Yeah, it's pretty big. It's also pretty impressive in
Another region of the world that has similarly impressive style architecture is there was a Polynesian kingdom, a very small one. They built essentially water gardens slash noble quarters called Nan Madol, which is also impressive in its own right since they legitimately built jetties and actually did geoengineering as well as this type of stuff.
So, because of how impressive they were, again, the Europeans denied that native Africans could have ever built it. So they believed it could either have been Egyptians, Lost Tribe of I Israel, or King Solomon. So it was either Egyptians or Jews.
Unironically, there's a reason I mentioned that Great Mutapa legitimately was likely the inspiration for King Solomon's mines.
Or at least
Now,
mines in the region.
here's something. I believe there has been some research, and there have been found in like South Africa some cultures and traditions that are similar or may have descended from ancient Jews,
I'm not surprised.
rather from like
Remember,
Ethiopian Jews.
the Beta Israeli
Yeah.
community as well as Aksum, both were influenced by Jewish peoples. I
so,
wouldn't be surprised if some of the rituals made it further south, at least partially. Even if they themselves were not. I mean, yeah, you could have had... the Great Zimbabwe might have actually been made by Jews. Shona Jews.
Great Zimbabwe is actually the third temple.
I mean, unironically, there's a commonality in a lot of African indigenous religions that they actually are monotheistic in outlook. Quite a few of them are.
Some of them are. It's again, it's
not
such a large
them,
area,
but
and there's
quite
so many
a
cultures.
Few of them are.
I'm hesitant to do any sort of generalization about African cultures because there's so many.
I'm not saying all of them. I'm saying quite a few were. So if you want to have a fun shit post, you could say hypothetically, Great Zimbabwe was made by ancestors of the Mutapa, who might have been of Jewish faith. We don't know. We don't know anything about them. I'd recommend not, because we do know about their predecessors better than we do them. And we sure as hell know about Mutapa better than we know either. So I would not recommend it, because it's not likely true. But it's very fun.
Right. So when we get into this, the next bit is the Mutapa Kingdom. It literally means the conquered land, because they came into the area, and they conquered it.
And it was literally conquered because he wanted salt.
Yep, they found salt. They built the kingdom into an empire. And they had a lot of copper. They had a lot of ivory. They had a lot of gold. And they had a lot of people willing to fight for that. Because they now strangled the trade routes down from the Somalian kingdoms towards the tip of Africa and across the continent again through like the Congo Basin and all this sort of stuff. So they had a huge trading monopoly. They had something that's stuff that everybody else wanted. And they were the only way to get it. And, oh yeah, they're willing to fight you over it.
Also, don't forget that this is around the time that trade routes were beginning to sweep closer to Zanzibar. So they had that as an advantage.
Yes, they did.
The Ottomans had shut off European trade to
that and also Oman was a very much a trading sultanate. And they were starting to build a trading colony on the island of Zanzibar. Basically, it was an attempt to make it a slightly more direct approach to the Swahili coast.
Right. Because then if you could bring it up the Swahili coast, then, you know, you don't have to deal with Oman.
And that's actually why Mutapa also did so well, because they were a way to get around Oman.
Yeah. So...
Although I'm,
where
I,
we are
I,
now.
I might be that might be retroactively because I think I it might be my knowledge is a little shaky on this area by a lot.
Yeah.
Zanzibar was it was a trade city, but I believe it was founded by Arab traders. But Oman,
it's further north.
Oman heavily invested in it in the 17th century and 18th century, not this time. Apologies.
Yeah, but still, it was a way to get around the Gulf of Aden.
It was also a way to get around the Somali. It was a way to get more direct access. Like, actually, this is why the Swahili coast did so well, because they could get it from Mutapa as well.
Yeah. So once we get into the Portuguese
show up. And here is what
Mutapa
looks like, by the way.
Yep.
They owned Tavara. They didn't go up to Kilwa, but they were up from Tavara. They got to the Great Rift Lakes around the Zambezi, all the way down to south of Great Zimbabwe to Torwa and the Limpopo. Like, basically, they ruled a large nation larger than the island of Madagascar.
Yeah, and much wealthier. The other thing that we should talk about is once the Portuguese get here in 1501, they get a stroke of luck. This happens occasionally, and this is actually a pretty big one for them. So there's the city of Sofala, which is trying to get independence from the Sultan of Kilwa. And Sofala is the trading city that the Mutapans would use to get up to the coast, right?
Yep, and if you're wondering, Kilwa was the most powerful of the Swahili city-states, if I recall.
Right, and because, again, they had stretch all the way down here. They got everywhere. So this independence is basically given by, well, gunships from Portugal who stumble onto the situation and are like, oh,
we ballin',
yeah, sure, we'll help you. we ballin'. And within the decade, they take over both cities because they're trying to dominate the trade route along the coast. This doesn't quite work out, and they become another middleman, basically. This would have been pretty much something that they were used to doing before, and it would have been okay. But then they get the rumors about the thing that makes Europeans in this
King
era
Solomon's mines
go absolutely batshit and march through jungles and go and try to take down entire empires. There's gold in them there hills.
Well, unironically, because the Swahili did mention, oh yeah, it goes further interior. That's where we're getting it all.
Yeah. So they go up into there. They start to try to infiltrate and, well, antagonize the locals against each other because it's just good business practice. Mm-hmm.
It gets great because here's the thing. Mutapa, they were influenced by Islamic traders and merchants, and they did actually invite and had converts to Islam. But the royal family...
The royal family was not.
And also a good portion of the country it wasn't.
Yeah, so...
It then culminates in the Jesuits managing to convert their king to Christianity, which results in a minor civil war.
Which results in the Muslim traders basically going, this is going to go bad. So they've managed to convince the king that, no. The best thing to go on is that, like... We need to figure out a way to get rid of this guy. So they convince a few days after he's baptized that you have to kill the guy because he's a Portuguese agent. He's not actually a devoted missionary. He's trying to trick you.
Yep.
So they strangle him and throw his body in the river.
Yep.
Where crocodiles eat him. Then the Portuguese
blame it on the Swahili.
Yes, they do. They blame it on the Swahilis and use that as an excuse to try to do a crusade into Africa.
It does not go well.
It does not work. They.
So technically, this is a whole conspiracy of the Jesuits.
It was. It was a Jesuit conspiracy.
Sort of.
Slightly.
The Jesuits were the excuse. The Portuguese traders were the ones that went, okay, there was a Jesuit missionary killed, so we can go in and invade this place. It was not the Jesuits saying we should go in and invade this place.
No, the Jesuits were genuinely trying to convert. However, the thing is, the Mutapa advisors, they saw what happened because, again, the Swahili city-states were reasonably powerful trade nations that got destroyed by the Portuguese. They do that a lot. They did that with Akka as well.
They're fighting the Ottomans right now. So, you know, there goes a lot of our trade money.
So they're basically going, okay, this guy has to be a tool of them. They're going to use it to basically destroy us. Kill him. They do.
Kill them.
They send an entire army because the traders are like, no, we need the money of King Solomon's mines.
They send a fantastically large army of 1,000 dudes named Zhao or something like that.
I mean, that's pretty impressive for the region.
It's pretty impressive in general that they were able to get them there.
Yeah, because to give you an idea, let's show off. There are no actual like ports that they had at the time. The best they had was they had a friendship trade. They had Sofala, but that's it. And they had a friendship treaty with the Kingdom of the Congo because they managed to convert one of the kings to Christianity at this time. So they still had to sail all around the fucking Cape to Sofala to put them there. Keep that
eventually,
in mind.
Eventually.
So, bear in mind, the conversion was in 1561. They don't get there until 1568.
That's how hard it is to get there, yes.
Well, no, 1568 is when they leave. When they get to the Upper Zambezi, it's 1572, and most of them are dead.
No, it's when they get back to their base in 1572.
So they spent 4 years trying to fight in there.
Trying to fight in the jungle. They get basically destroyed by disease. They walk home. And instead,
they decide to murder the Swahili.
The Swahilis, because it's like, well, okay, we can't take them over directly, so we're just going to do the next best thing and completely cut out the other middlemen. And when I say cut out, I mean that literally.
It's the Fourth Crusade all over again. We don't get to our location. We just kill the people there.
Yeah.
No. This is the Fourth Crusade.
At least they were Muslims this time and not other Christians.
Yeah, like for one thing, the Fourth Crusade is this gigantic, complete fuck up of planning from beginning to end.
The fact they got 1,000 really guys fun... here is a sign that they actually did a pretty good job planning this one.
Yeah, that they could get 1,000 guys basically about as far from Portugal as you could get at this time period, reasonably. And they managed to get them there. They managed to get them supplied. They managed to get them pointed in the right direction and to go and march towards the upper Zambezi.
Which, by the way, was almost completely uncharted. The only people who had maps were the Jesuits who were killed.
Yeah.
So they had no fucking clue. You gotta keep that in mind. They had no real clue other than basic information the Swahili traders could give them.
Yes. So thus the accidental crusade, because they kind of oopsed into it. So they managed to take a 50% duty on imported goods, but the main problem is this. So the Shona still have the trade routes into Africa. They demand tribute. You have to pay them. They also say duty. You have to pay us up all this shit. The problem is that you can't really invade it because they're a relatively united kingdom. Because you've got 1,000 dudes. They've got 10,000 dudes, and you've been selling them guns for the last 30 years.
Yep.
They know how to use them.
Oh, and don't forget, they could just use internal trade routes, because they did have those. If you're wondering where the internal trade routes were, basically they went up the Rift Valley, because there were a bunch of very small tribal states and kingdoms in the Rift Valley, so they would just send it up there until you got up to where maybe Somalia was.
Yeah, it's...
Or alternatively, up to the river in the Congo Basin, and they would just sell to the kings of Congo, and basically completely ignore Sofala.
Yeah, so either way, they could get their money, because there was other trade routes. They didn't have to rely on the Portuguese. So eventually, though, there is infighting within the kingdom, and the Portuguese, as all good Europeans do at any time that there is someone not in Europe that is infighting, they immediately swoop in and exploit the situation. They managed to get a foothold by 1629, and they are able to essentially completely dominate the empire by 1663. However, there is a bit of a thing. There's another dynasty of local rulers that does compete with the Mutapans, overthrows them, starts contesting with the Portuguese. Just sort of that sort of thing. But basically put, the Portuguese are still in charge. There is a temporary independence in 1720.
It doesn't last so long.
It doesn't last so long. By 20 years later, they're inviting the Portuguese back. And then they get into another civil war in 1759, which basically ends their independence. Which you have to admit, they lasted a lot longer than a lot of other places in close contact with the Portuguese.
They really actually kicked their ass a few times.
They actually won sometimes, yes. Which, I mean, I like. Let's look at the Aztecs in comparison. Like, they got fucking bodied by a smaller force,
like 100 guys, because they pissed off every tribe around them.
Yeah. Meanwhile, Mutapa is able to maintain relative independence for like 300 years, almost.
That being violent slave owners kind of pisses off the neighbors that you're enslaving.
Well, everyone was violent slave owners. This is the fucking age of exploration.
On top of that, yes, the Shona did export slaves. They were not major slave traders, but yes, they did employ slaves.
Everybody did in this time period. Everyone.
Yeah.
The main difference is in scale.
It wasn't chattel.
And it was chattel slavery to a degree, but it's like we're talking like scale wise. Like, there's nothing compared to what was happening over in the New World with the triangle trade in West Africa.
Which, by the way, made like, yes, the conditions of the Arab slaves were a million times were quite worse, but the triangle trade was an order of magnitude larger.
Yeah, like there for every one person in Arab slavery, there's probably like 10 people dying in a farm in the Caribbean.
Yeah.
Just to give you an idea of the size. The scale is so much larger, it's not even funny.
Don't get me wrong, the Arab one was pretty big. And the Arab like one was still pretty big, but triangle trade.
The scale, though, is... Yeah.
As for what Mutapa mostly got slaves for, again, gold mining. Gold mining and mining. Salt and salt pan fl- and salt plans.
Yeah, like mining. Literally, this is one of the main things that the Romans used slaves for. Like, most Roman slaves were treated pretty decently if you weren't in the mines. If you're in the mines, you're going to be worked to death because you got to get that gold, you got to get that silver, you got to get that lead. Enjoy the mercury poisoning, by the way.
I mean, if you were lucky, you merely were extracting salt, which was usually done via panning, or in some cases you do mine it, which is not great.
It's not fun. It's pretty painful.
It's less bad than gold mining, though, which genuinely runs the risk of poisoning.
Yes. The Romans did a lot of mining. People forget this. They did a lot of it. We have evidence of their mining everywhere across Europe.
The first West African kingdom actually got its got the first Saharan crossroad into the Roman Empire was solely for slaves. Yes.
Yes, because the Romans are like, we need more slaves for our mines. So,
so I believe
are you
it
willing
was the,
to trade?
It was the first. I think it might have been called Ghana. It might have been called the Kingdom of Ghana. It's like one of the first yeah. West African kingdoms. Basically,
it's one of the first ones that
sure,
we have contact with. Yeah,
sure,
records,
in exchange, give us salt.
Yeah, literally salt, slaves, gold, all that yeah. that just got traded back and forth. If you've got a commodity, people are going to be willing to trade for it and sell it.
Yeah, for denarii and salt. Well, for denarii, salt, and health, why not some salted fish, preserved fish? Sure, we'll sell yeah. two slaves.
Wine, why not? Yeah, well, it's a good deal. It's the ancient Roman stonks trading.
I'm just envisioning a person short selling a company that sells slaves.
No, I'm imagining the stonks guy. You know the guy yeah. with the tie, but he's in a toga.
Well, and, like, the
stonks
is like
with a V there in there instead of the O. It's like stonks.
Unironically, stock market trading and shares are as old as I believe Babylon.
There was sort of speculator markets, yeah.
Short selling is also as old as I believe not Babylon, but I think it's at least as old as Egypt.
Yeah. Anyway,
back to Mutapa with the Mwenambutapas, the kings.
Yes. So the Mutapa Empire is huge. The Limpopo and Zambezi River areas, the savannas between them, mountains. There's so many kinds of wildlife. They have, you know, legitimately one of the reasons why they're a major kingdom in the first place is that there's so many African elephants there. They are the ivory hub of the world.
Unironically, there were two regions in Africa known for its ivory selling. One is the Côte d'Ivoire in West Africa. This region was the East African equivalent.
Yeah. Had a lot. So, moving through, of course, there's storms through October to March. There's
they
long
go through
droughts.
Dries and wet seasons, which is very common in this region.
Very common along this sort of, yeah, along the coastlines. And another thing to note is that they are not homogenous. They nope. wanted to stress this to you.
The
They're not homogenous.
The ruling class, the major ethnicities beside them were the Tavara and Kore Kore. The Tavarans were the majority, and the Kore Kore migrated from the north.
Yeah, they're both technically Shona, but they're not the same. They'll object to that very much. Usually times they build themselves with their own clan structures with totems named usually after animals or body parts along with objects. There's also the fact is that these ones are descended from that and they're exogamous, which is not uncommon among clan societies, mm-hmm. historically speaking. Basically, the idea is that your clan marries outside of the clan. This brings in new blood. It reinforces ties with other clans. It ends feuds, brings peace, brings trade, brings friendship, but can also bring conflict.
Another thing that is very common is sacrifices do occur for the totems. Prayers are also common. Ritualistic dances are also very common. The Mwenambutapa, which is the term for the king, they don't worship the totem, though.
Right.
They don't actually prescribe any significance to the animal.
Yeah. It's just a symbol. It's like we designate ourselves as to distinguish ourselves from the others. It's
I'm
not
just envisioning
anything
a very
significant.
Confused Portuguese trader going, "You killed your own totem," and he's like, "So no, that's
no, it's
an
not
animal.
A totem. It's just an animal."
Why'd you?
Totem's different. Totem's very different.
Because it tastes good, and I want the teeth to make like a necklace.
Yeah, so they make a point here that they integrate each other, they intermarry, they move around. There's a lot of this sort of clan structure in society. There's actually like two different, for example, elephant clans, and they are both competing with each other over a lot of the trade. And they claim, no, we're the real elephant clan. They're the imposters.
What's also important is the dance. There's a performing a dance of a totem, which connects the person to their ancestors all the way back to the founder. It's a Mahadoro.
That's the founding figure to take of the clan.
Yeah, to take the step of changing Mutopos, cannot do so until they have mastered the dance of the adoptive Mutopo to the satisfaction of its Mahadoro.
Also, one of the recent clans that got a lot of power during this time was the Hanagaiwa Marunga, the pigeon clans, mainly because they traded heavily with the Portuguese.
And they basically built slave armies, which people think, why would you give slaves weapons? And the answer to that is, why wouldn't you give slaves weapons? Where else are they going? It's a great way to instantly raise a force that is relatively loyal, because it's like, yeah, we bought you, but if you fight, chances are you can buy yourself free, or, you know, stick around and get good stuff.
It's both interesting because the Janissaries were kind of the same approach, and they were the core of the best fighters in the Ottoman Empire, at least initially.
Yes, there's a lot of this that happens historically. People forget that slave armies
that slave armies are not trash. They're usually pretty good.
Slave bodyguards are also not uncommon, historically speaking, because it's the same principle, right? Mm-hmm. This man owes me everything. Why the fuck would he betray me?
I mean, that was the origins of the Varangian Guard. It was basically a bunch of dummies start raiding down towards Byzantium. And
you capture some
captured.
Of them.
Yeah.
And then
eventually it just became a rite of passage.
Basically, yeah. It's like, you want to make bank? Go down here. They'll take you in. You'll get money. You'll get training. It doesn't matter where you're from or if you're fleeing for whatever reason. Chances are, by the time you get back home, if you go home, everyone's going to forget about that. And you've got the jangly new shiny keys to shake in their faces with all your hard-earned money. So
here's something fun. Historical figures. When the Mutapa families frequently edit historical figures into their ancestral past, they unironically pull the Wiwes Kangs excuse with a variety
they
of
do.
People.
This is one of those interesting things about the genealogical records about these people, is that because it's more politically convenient to be part of one larger clan or another, you just come up with some excuse to change your ancestral figure.
This is why they claim to be of Zimbabwe, even though they weren't, actually. They conquered it.
Yes, this is. They literally go and they grab that bit and they say, well, we're this because we say so. And in the tradition of humans everywhere across time, it's quite fun. if you're ever building a setting, keep that in mind, that it is not uncommon for people to immediately change their ancestry because it's politically convenient. You merely need to look at modern day Anatolia for this.
Yep. Another fun one is actually the Kingdom of Pontus. Particularly, I believe it was Mithridates VI. He was well known because Pontus was, in classical periods, it was founded by an actual, I believe it was like a lower level noble, not an actual satrap, but like a lower level noble from the Achaemenid Empire, who basically with like 20 guys took a single fort and formed a kingdom out of that. He is of Persian stock, but the region also has a lot of Greek coastal cities. So what he commonly would do is he would change and adopt dress based on either the whims of the court or who he was appealing to. If he was appealing to, say, the Parthians, he would have adopted the dress of a Persian. If he was talking to Greeks or Romans, he would have done the same. He would have dressed as a Greek and played up the Greek aspect because he technically came from both lineages.
Right. And this also leads into a fun bit with some clans, because they all claim this ancestry of this big chieftainess, right? Mm-hmm. And she supposedly organizes a great alliance and leads them into a land that was shown to her, and they get there, they marry into that family, and the family totem changes, and so therefore they are the new clan. And of course, the other chief then says, well, you need to marry me now because you're obviously more powerful magically and your ancestry is stronger or whatever. You know, basic like, this is our excuse for, this is why we're here now. Again, I'm not denigrating it. This is just a thing that we see across mythology all the time. And folk tales and all this is like how you move into an area. And this is an interesting one where it's like, they didn't actually take it over, according to them. They said, we married into it.
Yep. So here's a fun thing about the religion of their people. They've revolves around spirits, a lot of spirits. The most powerful of them all is Mwari, the all-powerful creator god. Missionaries, like Christians, the Jesuits really tried to hammer that Mwari is a god. But the thing is, Mwari is the source of all things, for good and for ill. It is the creator god of everything. All the good, all the bad, all the kind, all the evil, all the cruel.
So they don't talk to him directly, basically. This is their big thing. You don't talk to him directly. Just don't. If you do, it's because it's usually bad. You're saying it's, oh yeah, because Mwari did it.
So and you usually you instead will go to the Mundoro, which are the teaching spirits.
Like the spirits that actually do things. This is it's an interesting tier system, almost you could say, like, of like, you've got the big guy, and then you got your saints, kind of.
The Mundoro are the equivalent to the clan. They're not quite the clan totems, but they are the spirits that guide that specific clan, that specific region or tribe. Then there's the Vadzimu, which are for families. They're tutelage families.
Right. And then there's your direct ancestors, the Mudzimi.
And then last but not least, there's the Shavi, which are foreign spirits. They exist, and essentially, they don't communicate with them, but they, in exchange for the medium's prayer and rituals of remembrance, they are granted knowledge by them.
And I want to note from a perspective of someone that is really into Glorantha, this is a really clever thing. I swear that this was taken into it, but because it's like, this is how you adopt a god or a spirit cult. It's like, it doesn't necessarily have to be from your area. It's someone that did something important. They should get veneration. That way your group gets their skills. It's kind of that way that that's how it works. These talented foreigners. Right?
Yep.
It's their way of adopting in these outsiders and these outside concepts into the society.
They also sometimes would eventually become family spirits.
Right.
And yes, the Shona were well known to employ mediums and witchcraftery. Their main thing is by communicating with the spirits via ritualistic dance or chanting, while dressed in their aspect, in their costume.
Yeah. It's all this is really fascinating.
Oh, it's there's a reason why I knew that we could definitely, like, I'm very finding this fun, especially since they even mentioned that because of the way mediums work, you can very easily slot in a Geist game in Mutapa, and it works perfectly.
Easily. You could do Geist, you could do Werewolf, you could do basically anything that has to do with spirits in some way, shape, or form, and it would probably work.
Well, so specifically the Wedzinza, which are a descendant, because the Mudzimu, the grandfather spirits, usually will target a specific person to serve as their vessel.
Right.
And Wedzinza tend to be Sin Eaters. I mean, not always, but it's pretty common. At least in the world of in Chronicles of Darkness, like not common, but if you're playing a Sin Eater, you're probably the Wedzinza.
Yeah, and they mentioned that there is no global culture of Sin Eaters at this time, so yeah, you are what you are here, which is I'm obviously one of these people because this is the culturally thing that I would be, because it's like back in Europe at this time period, a lot of the people that are Sin Eaters see themselves as folk exorcists. Folk magicians.
They bring up that it's dangerous to be unkind to one's parents. If a living ancestor goes to their grave angry, they don't simply vanish. They become a spirit and haunts not only their child, but all the descendants after as a malevolent Ngozi.
Yeah, that can happen.
That's definitely where geist would be appropriate.
I mean, it does happen. If you're particularly silly about how you treated your folks in life, they can haunt the shit out of you in death. You know what's really fun? I actually kind of tapped a little bit into this with this necromancer I built for a D&D game. Unironically, he was constantly tormented by his annoying uncle, who also was a necromancer, who basically stuck to him as a spirit to just try to talk to him and give him very annoying advice. But the most respected of the Wedzinza are Ngangas. Wedzinzas, these are the ones that actually host spirits that were mediums in life.
Yeah. So basically, the spirit of someone who could talk to spirits. Obviously, that's going to be a much more powerful spirit. QED.
The
It's obvious.
equivalent version is the varoyi. Varoyi is a term for witch. Basically the same approach. The spirit used to be a witch. These guys are seen in a much more ill light because witchcraft can be quite malevolent. It can be useful, but it can be quite malevolent depending on if you've offended them.
Right, it's your classic folk magic.
And they introduced new supernatural merits, specifically for this region.
Yes, so the Sirvoko, which requires you to be either awakened or a sleepwalker, and you're a medium.
You
Which
choose
kind of neat.
Wamasikati or Wedzinza when you approach this marriage. Wamasikati has successfully attracted the attention of one or more Shavi or foreign Varoyi. They have the resonant or anchor condition when interacting with any ephemeral activity. They can spend a point of willpower to get the open condition, which regards to ephemeral entities within 5 yards. Wedzinza has been chosen by one of their ancestors, though. And there's Zvikiro channel. When
Yep,
it's fettered, it can communicate.
which is basically you can channel them to go somewhere. There's one where you can make them sort of obey you while they're possessing you. There's one where you can enjoy both the benefits of being both types of medium. So very flavorful, very useful. You could easily adapt these to any other setting, honestly, mechanically speaking.
I like how by the way, the chat is talking about the effects of Japan being too close to the Portuguese. They had the sun dropped on them twice. That is true, Squirrel Killer. They had the power of the sun dropped on them twice. That's all I'm going to say about that because this is Mutapa time. Is it?
You know what I realized though? You talk about the accidental crusade and this.
Sort of
Makes
an
me want to
afterthought,
play.
because it really is. It really is just kind of an afterthought.
It's fucking Vietnam, in a way.
Yes and no.
I ain't
The
no
region.
fortunate
The
yow.
savannas are speaking Shona.
When the trees
But
speak
also, I'm
in
thinking.
Vietnamese, when the caves speak Japanese, when the savannas speak Shona.
But I'm imagining you playing as a team of awakened, fighting, the Portuguese, and you have to team up with the were-crocodile tribe.
I mean, you could do that. A really fun one is because they specifically mention the tribes constantly, not the tribes, but the clans constantly getting into conflict just over their totems. And on top of that, you can have the insidious Weasley weapons shipments that are speaking Portuguese. My name is
Yeah,
Hua,
oh,
my
no,
name is
wait.
Xiao, and
No.
I have 1,000 guns in exchange for this gold.
Yes, give me the
Fuck
gold.
were crocodiles. Fuck the wizards. You play as were
Well, you're also
elephants.
for yeah. I was about to say you went to were crocodiles. I would have gone immediately to the were
You could
elephants
do.
because
Oh
like.
God, you could totally do a full war for Gaia with them. It's like we have
Yeah,
come to
you. This
avenge our
is.
kin slain by you for the trade with the people from the boats.
Oh no,
You could
okay, hold
easily
on.
do were elephant games, and it wouldn't be too out of place here. I don't know why you would
I
want to, but you could.
got an idea. Christian were elephants versus Muslim were crocodiles.
I mean, the elephants would win, dude. It's not even a fight. The
It's
way they're
the were
statted.
elephants, like the way that they're statted.
Like,
Jeez.
come on.
Yes.
It's just
I was
kind
imagining it's
of.
also now a religious holy war.
That's kind of losing the interest for me, honestly.
Yes, they go in and they talk
Because
about, of course,
religion's
the.
not a huge thing for this setting.
It is, but it isn't.
It isn't and isn't. It's
The
more.
main thing that they talk about is like how the clothing is depends on the area. And I do like how they talk about that jewelry is actually a very significant part of this. So like
Well, also tributaries
what
and
how you,
traders.
yeah, how you dress matters to like which clan you have. Like this clan is the one that has this kind of piercings. No other clan does this.
Yep, so ruling families have access to goods from all around the world. They have silk and cotton that are brightly dyed. They have exotic animals from far-off lands. Unironically, the leading family, the ruling king of Mutapa, the Mutapa, legitimately, you could have them have a full-on zoo filled with like animals from Asia, like China and Japan, as well as the Americas. Like they could have a jaguar.
Yeah, like the stuff
Sorry.
of this is like they've had guns for a long time. It's just that they've been curiosities because they've got like five of them and they're like, this is kind of shit.
There's not much of a point because when it gets damp, they don't really fire.
They don't fire and they get damp. There's not a lot of them, and it's like, why the fuck would you want these?
Why
Like
would you
they
really like
don't.
you can use them to kill a guy, but like, you know what also does it? Arrow.
Arrow or a fucking
And you know what
spear.
I
It's
can
like,
and you know what I can do with arrow that I can't do with gun? Use it during the rainy season.
yes, they talk about a lot about like also that, yeah, they do have bows. They have throwing knives and javelins. They have
By the way, they actually
spears,
were good
steel
enough at
shields.
crafting. They can make steel. Keep that in mind.
They do have
Steel shields and
steel.
spears.
They do have forged armor, but they don't generally didn't do like full steel
It's too
breastplates or
hot.
things like that.
It's really
It's too
hot.
hot.
So what they'll usually, it's similar to the Egyptian armies of old, where they would usually use cloth padding.
Yeah, it's like why would you want like yeah, like why
It's
would you
also
want to
very
wear
common.
chainmail?
It's also
It's
very
protective,
common
but it's like
for
you're gonna
you to
fucking
wear
die.
animal hides to show off, yeah, I killed this.
I killed this. Yeah, I killed this fucking lion. I'm gonna wear this lion at ceremonies because it shows that I'm a badass.
Or alternatively, you get the guy who's wearing a crocodile hat, like the head of the crocodile is a hat, and it's like wearing it as like a cloak.
Yeah.
I killed it with this. Pulls out the steel knife.
Yes, so they go in then to
They
what are the
love bright
Portuguese doing?
colors, specifically.
Yeah. Bright colors, of course, are valuable. Everyone likes bright colors. Dyes are a huge part of the trade networks all time.
Even the on the outs family, like the only sort of middle class, usually does have at least some gold or ivory.
Yeah, because there's so much of it. Usually it's heirloom jewelry.
As for when
And
they go to war, warriors traditionally have round or oval shields made of steel and spear
yeah,
and
they
breasted
went with
spears.
yeah, because it's like you why would you want the steel as your armor? Armor is hot and heavy and all that. If I make a decently sized steel shield, well, that's pretty effective. Think about like the bronze shields that you would see sometimes, like that hoplites would have and all that. Think about that. And yeah, it's heavy. But you're not wearing the rest of the armor with it, so it's not the worst thing to carry around. It's pretty protective, and it's
And
not like
also
it's going to
have
get busted.
throwing daggers
Oops,
or
sorry.
even guns.
Yeah,
Besides, they're
yeah, they
saying.
use throwing daggers,
As
which, by
I
the way, are usually their eating knives.
Yeah. Well, they can be eating knives. That's just one of those, like, most of the time, though, if you're throwing weapon, be a javelin because javelins are based, and yeah, you'd use those
Also,
instead.
unironically, at least on one occasion, there has been like you can unironically have a noble or even the current king of the Mutapa openly show off this Crusader era armor. Like, oh yeah, I bought this. Allegedly, it was worn by some guy named Redbeard. It's
Yeah,
Barbarossa's armor.
they do. They'd buy armor from across. It's the same thing that people will do, like with buying just like strange knickknacks from all around the place. They bought armor because they don't use that armor, but it's neat. It's something to have around your palace to be like, ah, yes, this is a sign of how wealthy I am, and also how cool this is. Like this thing's fucking cool. As he's like, you're looking at some like a weird mishmash of Chinese, Chinese style mail mixed with like a European helm, and then like, I don't know, some scimitar somewhere, and he's got them all propped up together because he doesn't know.
Yeah.
And you might not know either. So you're like, that's pretty cool.
From you know? Hey, there's a bit from Squirrel Killer. Wait, I just noticed this is a mage setting that isn't dense as fuck. I know, isn't it magical?
It's not. It's great. We're going to get into the mage in a little bit, though.
Yep. Also, the majority of Shona, like, this is the nobility. Most Shona, they're not that rich. They are they are ranchers. They herd cattle and other livestock, and they have personal gardens. This is a very common thing in not every African society. You can't say that. But this is also very popular in West African societies where they have small personal gardens. It's also very popular. Well, it was very popular in Europe, unironically, because it's very trivial to set up a small personal garden.
Also, ceremonial cattle raiding, very common. Like, think like the kind of cattle raiding you'd see in like early Europe or even like Ireland and up into this period, mm-hmm. where like you'd have a bunch of young guys go out, find the other guy's cows and steal them. And the back and forth, and sometimes someone would get killed, but sometimes they wouldn't, and you'd posture with your weapons and be like, I'm really tough, and you shouldn't fight me.
One of the greatest flexes, by the way, is if you're a particularly wealthy herdsman, you have the ability to let them range far out from your homestead.
Yeah, like, that's one of the things, is it's literally daring someone, like, no, if you steal this, I can still get this back. And none of the people around it are gonna try to steal it from you. That's how you know I'm a big deal.
Well, that's one of two. The other is, you can steal it all you fucking want. I have so many cows. I could lose like two or three of them and I won't care.
Yeah. And the other thing with that is that they can then extract tribute from neighboring families to replace that stolen cattle. So it's like, yeah, feel free to steal. I'll just get it back and you're going to pay for it.
Though that tributary kind of also led to the empire's downfall.
Collapse, yes. Because while it was a relatively centralized state, on the fringes, it was not.
And that's where the Portuguese exploited.
Yes, they did.
Speaking of the Portuguese, they were starting to explore this area for a long time. They only really got to this place in the early 1500s, but they kind of had already knew that there was this place called Sofala that was a big connection to India that had a lot of gold. So they sent an expedition there, and then that's where they kind of started to move on from there.
Yep, they started a trading post at... They noticed as they continued to trade and slowly dominate the city that they're not mining gold. It's coming from the interior.
Right. The Sofala basically becomes irrelevant eventually because it's like they don't need anything really out of it, and it's more of just a way station to India. Because remember, their objective is the Indian trade, not the African trade.
Also, once they took Kilwa, it kind of didn't matter.
Yeah, also that.
Also, Mozambique was much more popular for them to set up at.
Yeah. So they did have a bit of it where they're talking with, like, Portugal. The missionaries. Missionaries would, of course, record a lot about local beliefs and the best way to make it look like your own. This is the Jesuits were very good at syncretizing beliefs of natives into generally something that could be acceptable Catholic doctrine as, like, a foot in the door to really bring the Jesus.
Which, because the way the Shona religion worked, it's actually not that hard. Their tears
no,
and spirits
not.
Are very similar to how saints work.
How and, saints work, how well, the apostles work, how the Holy Spirit works. Yeah, you can
I mean, the only issue is trying to redirect how Moari is covered, but it's not that hard. It's a supreme creator deity. He serves the role as father quite well.
Yeah. And you might think about this, where it's like, this is a... the missionaries are... writing all this stuff for good reason, because for one thing, it's very dangerous work, because it's like going to the sea, that's dangerous travel. Going on inland, you might get eaten by a crocodile, and then there's always the chance that someone is not too kind about tastes too kindly about your beliefs.
More than once missionaries have been killed in China, even during this period of the Ming.
Yes. And of course you have to have sort of like an amount of zeal to do this. The basics, though, is that this is helpful to the nature of the Portuguese colonization, because there's not a lot of them there. So what they want to do instead is they want to have as many native allies as possible. Mm-hmm. And converting them to your religion is a great way to do that. That's what the Muslim traders have been doing for generations.
It didn't quite work for Mutapa, mainly because it's kind of interior, and it's kind of a thing to get there.
Welcome to how the Swahili became Muslim. A lot of them along the coast. The Somalis, sorry, not the Swahilis.
Well, a lot of Swahilis also were Muslim, but not all of them.
Yeah. But yes, so like the Acheron Sultanate, which it's fun that they mention that, because that's always, it's always fun to see people actually do historical research into this. But yes, the Ottomans and the Acheron have a very big stake in this, because first off, they have a lot of connection to the Silk Road and the Golden Ivory. So they get that, they bring that in to everyone else, that makes a lot of money. Then we have the Ottomans, who by closing Constantinople to traders in 1453, because they took the city, kind of caused a lot of goods from India and China to skyrocket in value, and to Europeans, which
especially since
benefited.
They banned Portugal specifically, and they raised tariffs on the other kingdoms. I believe they specifically banned Portugal. Or was it all Europeans? I forget.
It was all. It was basically all Europeans.
I know the first one. Yeah, I knew the first one was Portugal because they hated them.
Yes. It's kind of funny because the Ottomans, the Portuguese, will proceed to, over the next century or so, fight a variety of these weird brush fire wars basically all across India and the Indian Ocean.
You forgot the funniest one, where they legitimately fought a proxy war in Malaysia.
Over
the Straits of Malacca. Like, they legitimately did full... Like, you think the Cold War between the USSR and the USA... No, nothing was greater than the Portuguese-Ottoman hyper war.
Like, yeah, it lasted, like, over 100 years. It's really funny. It's all over... I want some goddamn pepper, is basically the boils down to why these two massive empires are fighting each other. I want the spicy leaf. Give me the spicy leaf.
No.
No. Then war it is.
And thus the battle begun, and you like see stages in Africa.
Yeah, it's just.
It's basically the Family Guy joke between the birds and the hornets.
Haven't seen that one, but yeah.
It's a shitpost where Peter blames throwing a rock at a hornet's nest on a bird, and then they literally wasted a gag building like this epic fight between them, almost like in the style of Lord of the Rings. And then it cuts to Peter just popping in going, yeah, about that. We would have animated the rest of it, but we ran out of budget for this episode, so end joke?
Oh, that's even worse.
This modern Family Guy?
I think it was, but it's one of their few pretty decent jokes.
But yeah, so they talk about this.
So the great
Ottoman-Portuguese
war.
Where the Mutapa is basically becoming a proxy ground somewhat for the Ottoman-Portuguese struggles, but also the trade.
It's also a source of gold, which...
Yeah, it's also the trade struggles are also part of this. And then we get into the actual supernatural of this, because
This was all the mundane.
So the basics of this, and it's kind of simple, is that mage, mummy, and other settings are down to the basic principles. They're going through all of this, and they're like, why is this not here? It's not like a reskinning, because it's like they're making a point of, how do we actually know that there's a supernal? How do we actually know any of that? Like, that's all stuff that the mages have discovered on their own, theoretically, or it's their way, the paradigm that they view their connection with whatever the hell is beyond. And their ability to do magic. It doesn't necessarily have to be true, but it doesn't necessarily have to be wrong either. So it's there. It's kind of one of those things where it's like the mages of the Shona are different than these. It's more grounded, I guess would be the way to put it. They're not going into these like massive diatribes of, in the golden age of whatever the fuck this philosopher said, blah, 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 blah. They're sticking to what they know.
And this is
compared to Greeks, which make everything, compared to Greeks, which make everything more
epic, grand scale. Like, oh, it was the great fall from. Meanwhile, they're like, no, we're spiritual mediums. We're not the only ones out there. There's other mediums out there. It's just we have the ability to talk to the greater spirits from history.
Yeah, they also go into the whole the underworld of mummy is not necessarily the same as the underworld of Geist, but it could be if you wanted it to be. It could be a different realm entirely. There's a lot of stuff that you can play around with it.
Especially since I believe Mummy was still getting worked on partially. Like, I think it
Was
came
there
out.
was still some there's yeah there's still some stuff being worked on with Mummy at this point, but more importantly, they were already working on second edition Mummy,
Yeah, so they were
like
just
in the
trying
background.
to, they were just playing around a little bit here and there with it.
Yeah, because this is 2017, and I think second edition Mummy came out in 2022. So they're probably in the early stages of how do we update Mummy?
So here's the point of view from the Zvikaro, the native form of mage. Atlantis, the Great Fall, the
They don't care about any of that. They don't know any of that,
they don't know any of that.
frankly.
It's garbage. Instead, this is
Doesn't
what they
matter.
know.
It's Grug Mage time. Like that shit doesn't matter. Toss it out the window. Doesn't matter.
It's trash. All they know is this, that there are cyclical periods of greatness throughout history, and that there are mythic heroes that went above and beyond and enter the presence of Moari. Moari is their version of the supernal world. It is the creator, like, it is all aspects.
Yeah, so
They see themselves as almost tapping into or indirectly beseeching this uncaring massive force to gain the power that they do.
yeah, and they see the supernal, of course, through their own worldview. They don't see it through the worldview that most mages see it through because they don't have that baggage, at least that you're used to. So that's completely different.
There's a variety of Mondoros, but the Mondoros, but the f there are five in specific that call to mo that call to them, that call to the many Zvikiros. Those five,
The first is the Chivalry of Iron, or the Iron God,
The Moros
the
path
Lord of the
is who
North.
it... Yeah, the Moros is their first one because, well, okay, the so-called Iron God, because matter and death are very important, things like that. You're talking about this as their ancestor is Chimamombe. You know, he doesn't appear, but he manifests as a river. So his spirits from his line appear as the mediums. Because remember, the Supernal views how you look at it. So a mage that's used to this sort of thing is going to see the Supernal beings of like, oh, wraiths or whatever else as wraiths of their ancestors or whatever else. Kind of important.
Yeah,
The
Chimombe never makes it, he never appears. He just manifests, yeah.
Yeah.
Because he's dead.
So obviously they say that his dark kana are death and matter because that makes sense. Iron and salt. You know, the two things that built the kingdoms, the two things that are really important, you
Also,
could
a
say.
very important thing for them is water. Each of them have a water aspect. Chimombe's is drying of the river, which is fitting because to the Shona peoples, as well as the previous kingdoms that they adopted from, that
Yeah.
is the decline and end of their state.
Yeah, it's also a note that they want to make is that this is all the subjective view of these people.
Yeah.
This is not necessarily some grand metaphysical statement about the world of Mage.
This is how they see it. This is how they see this specific tower.
Yeah. The real are defined by whatever the tradition is, not the contents of a game. Like this is still an actively believed belief system here. This is not like some
And unironically, if you wanted to have these types of mages still be a thing, go ahead.
You can. You totally can. The society, the culture still exists. They still have many of their traditions and all this sort of stuff. If you wanted to have a mage that views this the world the same way as their ancestors did, feel free. That's probably a
Also,
metaphysically powerful thing.
on top of that, this is a great way to just kind of low-key hint. If you really think mage metaplot gets too fucking high bar or wordy, you don't
You can just
have
reduce it. You can easily pry it down from giant exarch shit to yo, we got just this.
Like, you could have one tradition go into the fall of Atlantis and the Exarchs being the this you could also then just have the
Then
more
another order that's just like, I don't give a shit. Like,
like if you wanted
okay,
to
fine. Come on.
you could have him go, you're talking about this thing like a fallen greatness and stuff. Oh, I just listen to the gods. They speak through me. The five ones that care about men because they're like
They're fucking
Vikings.
Scotsmen, yeah,
They're
or
Scots
whatever, yeah.
Vikings.
Why not? Go for it. The next one up, of course, is Mestizos. Which as is twins, Chingu and Murata came as conquered lands together. So Chingu used his spear to open a beehive, but Murata delayed his journey, and so
it's
on
Mutota,
and so forth.
Mutota, not Murata. Mutota.
Oh, I misread that. Sorry. The point being, though, that...
Eventually they encounter the godlike warrior Nyamazunzu.
He couldn't defeat it, so to give his descendant's daughter in marriage, then during the celebration, after the guy got drunk, he fucking decapitated him. Yes. Then annihilated his people, claimed their territory.
This is also possibly a slight reference to how Mutapa took and founded itself.
Possibly. Like, you know, it's we're dealing with like, you know, oral tradition. That
which
is
one of the fun things you can do with mages. You literally don't have to do any of it. It may be the objective idea, but that's not necessarily how your mage is going to see it.
Yeah, and of course, ruling Arcana as all vestigios, mind and space, they make a point that like how they awaken is also slightly different because of how the perspective of everything is, but that's not really a thing that you should as a
they do mention
GM.
Some taboos that recommendations, like if you're of Chingu, the line of Chingu, you're not going to likely get drunk because that is legitimately losing yourself.
Yeah, like they mentioned like the matter and the yeah, because then there's Divigaru of the Rains.
Zvizaguru.
Legends differ whether it's male or female, because they're so ancient it doesn't fucking matter.
Yep.
In one legend they control the light and the darkness by trapping sunbirds.
Which
and another
an
they travel across the lands
region,
to bring
yes.
rain.
Became
one with
the
land and the waters. Yeah.
Zen to serve them. They never married them, but walked into a deep pool, becoming one with the land. Zvizaguru still lives among the rain because of this.
Yeah, they didn't actually have some descendants, and then
also legitimately again water and aspects. Chingu's is water and vessels.
Yeah, and of course the thyrsus is the water of the rain, the natural world coming in. Awakening often involves you going out into the woods
and meditating and listening to water. Their main arcana are life and spirit. This is the healing and lineage traditionally.
Yeah, of course, because water is the medium of life and death is dust. You don't have water, you die.
Also, another thing, you can unironically have a theorist or Zvizaguru who specializes in fighting evil spirits and binding them.
Yeah, because life and spirit. It's that sort of nature of it. Obrimos is a fun one, because Obrimos are just fun in general.
This is Mutota, the twin brother of Chingu.
Yes. He came here in search of salt.
Also, Mutota is called the lineage of kings because he is the legitimate personal founding ancestor to the current Mwenanupe.
One of the royal dynasties, yes. Mm-hmm. There's a lot. There's a lot of people that claim their descent from him. So it's sort of like, in fact, there is a future revolutionary that will claim descent from this guy.
Yes, they do.
There is, of course, water that thus is storms, because storms are violent. They're violent, impressive forces all over the place. That's Obrimos. Obrimos are the guys that throw lightning around.
And in this case, it is symbolically encountering both water and earth, as well as the Joseph Campbell's Heroes Quest.
Yes.
Unironically, I think you might like this one a lot, because doesn't this feel, as we're talking about this, more and more kind of like what Glorantha was kind of aiming for?
Yeah, it feels very Glorantha of like, how do you adapt something like this to an existing belief system? And without stepping all over it. Mm-hmm. Which is
so,
hard
so
to
the
do.
So the ruling arcana are forces and prime.
Yes.
These are royal privileges. Force creates storms. Prime grants settler authority. And the inferior arcana is death.
Because why should a king care about the ghosts?
The king manages and rules the living. Leave that to the others.
Yeah. And then we get the lineage of the four eyes. Yes. And... mist is their water. There's like a lot of other stuff. I'm trying so that we can get through this without it taking
No, we're good.
Too long.
We're good. We still have we're only at less than an hour and a half in still.
Oh, and we're almost to Mummy. That's good.
You're
so
fine.
So they have the Lineage of Kings where it's like the...
Well, they're the lineage of the Four Eyes.
Four Eyes, sorry.
Time.
Yeah, Fate and Time, beginning and end of dynasties, because they're kind of related to that. They're the guy that got decapitated.
Mm-hmm.
The stories also, of course, raw power cannot ensure success. This
because
is the lineage of subtle ways.
Because their ancestor lost even though he was strong. Jingu just tricked and killed him. Which I think is kind of a nice touch there.
Yeah, and then we get into the take that they have on the diamond. Which makes some sense.
Yep, Mutopos, four totems is one.
You have Mutupo, the Serpent's Eye.
Yeah, the basics are that this is like their clan, arguably, which is the order. So it's like the four great totem groups that admit only mages. All aspects of the Joka, the Great Serpent, or the Dragon, or the Pentacle, sort of like, well, the Diamond, the Dragon of Atlantis. There's a bunch of other stuff like this. They represent the convocation of the Mutapa Empire, though they wouldn't use that word themselves. That's more something like, oh, that the foreign mages use, and, you know, whatever.
Yep, Mutupo, which is they're known as the four aspects of the Joka. The Joka Mutopos is the term for their society.
Yes, they have parallels, but they're not necessarily the same thing. There's more of a, how would I put it? It's like the idea of an order is more of a fraternity. This is more of like a kinship group.
You're almost legitimately your own totem/clan.
Yeah, this is more like a clan feeling than it is for like an order. An order is something you belong to. A clan is something that you are. And I guess that's sort of like the you're much closer together.
So the first is the Serpent's Eye. Their main aspect is to benefit their community, magic must obey certain ritual strictures. Mediums of the Serpent Eye regulate social and moral laws of magic because they're the guardians of the veil, kind of.
Interestingly, here's one of the things they do, and I kind of like this as a distinction. Compared to the guardians, which will normally do some absolutely heinous shit for the greater good because of their own metaphysical beliefs, this branch of them says, we don't do that. We'll still look into the forbidden. We'll still touch it. And we'll still interact with it, but we won't use it. And that's a big distinction.
Because
like,
don't want to be witches.
Yes. Culturally speaking, that's a big taboo, and they don't want to do that. Meanwhile, over in Europe, the guardians are more than happy to do things that
eyes are bleeding as their flesh.
Yeah, falls. they'll fucking do that in order to get rid of the seers of the throne. They're not gonna hesitate to use every trick in their arsenal to do it. But here they don't, because they just don't. It's not a cultural thing they want to do.
Then there is the serpent scales. They study it for their own sake. They actually will look into, because again, there's more and more people. You got the Swahili traders as well as Portuguese showing up. They're the type of guys that look into their own traditions. They study them. But they're not part of they're similar to the Mysterium in that they do investigation, spying, but they're not quite.
Yeah, they're not the same. They're very similar, but they're not the same. They know they know a lot about other mages. They know a lot about how other mages will interact and all that.
They also
like...
will say they're of the Mysterium, but they really don't give a shit about the title. They're just using it because they're of a similar role and people won't.
If foreigners know the name, it makes sense to use the name around them.
Yeah.
We don't give it. It doesn't matter really to us, but it makes them happy when we use it, so we just use it.
There is the serpent's
then you
teeth.
Have the...
Unlike the adamantine atom arrows, they throw all.
They basically like the arrow. The arrows kind of go like, we don't want to rule. We're just here to protect. These guys go no.
No, we're kings.
To rule is to protect.
We're the leaders of these group clearly.
Yeah. A true ruler destroys the enemy, destroys the enmity and forges nations anew. So basically, they are. They're like they're warlords, which is kind of neat.
Yeah.
It's nice because like a lot of the arrow stuff is kind of like we're just soldiers in the eternal war and all this sort of like.
Meanwhile, these guys like nah, we are the not kings. We serve the king, but we are the head of the clan.
Yeah, we're the warrior princes, basically.
Then there's the serpent's tongue.
Parallels to the silver ladder, but
they're I guess you'd say like the court mage.
Yeah.
They're partially that, but they're also partially the diplomats. These would be the people that serve as the chancellor to the serpent's teeth. Because, again, since they're clan-like, it's a lot closer to how Mutapa runs their society. So it's almost like a miniature feudal state within the state.
Yeah. And then they talk, of course, about the...
I do like that the servant's tongue, they say... They counsel peace and cooperation, but they also have a certain degree of social stasis. Wealthy clans should keep their wealth, but share generously, and those who toil below them should stifle their complaints.
Well, that's because it favors them since they're in a high prestigious position themselves. Because a lot of these people are at the very least reasonably wealthy.
Yeah. So if we move on though to the foreign relations, because I think this is the most important thing, because outside the serpent is basically like these are the low status awakened. These are the ones that don't belong to one of the bigger groups. But like when we go into the foreign relations, this is where it gets really interesting. So
they
kind of have an idea about the outside world. They've dealt with foreigners as far away from them as China at some point, across Africa as well, because of course they're awakened, they can travel like that. They're most familiar with their neighboring peoples, but they're also relatively familiar with Portuguese awakened. There's not many mages, but once Portugal starts to enter direct relations, they start to really get in contact. Most belong to the diamond, and they're educated enough, along with the fact that the locals are educated enough to realize that, hey, wait a second, we have a lot of the same beliefs. We have a lot of the same ideas, and isn't that great? So let's try to get along.
And their response is no.
The response kind of is...
We're willing to talk, but we are not of you.
Kind of, yeah. We're willing to talk. And of course, then these foreign ones are like, yeah, there's another group that you haven't heard of yet. I don't know why. They just haven't gotten to you there. And...
I find it very fitting. It's not their fault. It's literally more European assholes' fault that this happens.
Yeah, it's like because the Europeans are assholes, because there's less reason to trust them. It's like, why the fuck are they talking about these people that we have to be aware of? There's no reason to do that. Meanwhile, the Praetorians, the ministries of the seers of the throne are infiltrating the kingdoms as they speak, because these guys, because they're isolationists, because they're all like that, they're not looking out for it. Because why the fuck would they listen to these foreigners?
Especially since they're not of this land, they don't know it.
Yeah. So the seers, basically, instead of directly trying to take over overtly, they just subvert it from the inside. They get inside of there.
Particularly mages that like to pretend that they're Jesuits. They legitimately often try to negotiate the that way.
Yeah, the Paternoster will use that. The Praetorians will use a few other there. There's the Merchant Mister ones that will do it. There's a lot of really clever uses of subversion in that. It's kind of fun. So we then go on to the mummies, but that could be an interesting campaign of like, oh fuck, they've actually managed to infiltrate and we have to deal with that now.
Yeah,
because it's like we didn't listen, and now it's almost too late, and we need to try to save our traditions from being completely absorbed by the seers.
Oh, hey, we're good. The no material from World of Darkness 5th edition will make its appearance. Oh, no, don't worry. We have, in this companion piece, there is a beast setting in it.
There is a beast setting.
We're not covering it in this book.
We're not
going to
cover it.
Not yet. Not this
story. I don't know if we'll even cover it. It's like, it's not even able to hate on it bad. It's just not
it
fun.
Exists.
It exists.
It is Reconstruction era beast.
It's one of those, why was this made? There is no purpose for it, and I don't want to even deem it. I don't
contemplate
even
on that concept. And,
yeah, I don't want to even deem it worth my attention because it's just such a non-entity. It doesn't even talk about like the details of it either. It's like it's just like, oh, here's some stuff about the war and a bit about after it and a bit about the antebellum south and nothing to fucking do with beasts.
Hilarious. Oh, no. You know what I should totally do at some point? I should just do an unhinged rant talking about how terrible Clan Thinblood and Thinblood Alchemy is. I fucking hate Thinblood Alchemy. I hate it so fucking much.
Right. So anyway.
Anyway,
back
to
something
mummy.
Else that will make you a little less
angry. Back to something that's great.
Mummy.
So for Mummy, it doesn't have influence the rise and fall of Great Zimbabwe. Exchange old fortresses for new when people abandon that empire and claim the conquered lands under a new wave of princes. So their position's a paradox. They're integrated by standing outside the ordinary order. So the people aware of them, arisen are embodied Shavi, but the foreign unburied dead who teach practical.
Who teach useful craft. Isn't that a nice coincidence? I think somebody stumbled upon that, and then that's where they got this entire idea for this whole thing, which is really clever.
The thing is, they are not true ancestors.
Well, no,
of course they aren't.
They're
not.
You give an Elder Scrolls reference, literal Daedra.
Yeah, they are. They're basically the Daedra. They are not our ancestors. The thing is that they're so powerful.
The continent, yeah, here's the thing. The Arisen share the continent, but they are not remotely in this area. Like, that is one thing you can say about Irem. It was not there.
Yeah, they also make a mention that most of the normal ancestor spirits that your average mage would be dealing with in regards to something close
fucking
to a mummy.
Hate mummies.
They don't like mummies. Mummies skeeve them out a lot, which is fair because mummies skeeve out a lot of things that can sense them. they're not really great. But the other thing to note is that they are Brazil is closer Brazil is closer to where mummies come from than this area of Africa.
Yeah.
That's how large Africa is.
Yeah.
Copenhagen is closer. Up in Denmark.
Yeah.
But they've still managed to get their way down here. They've weaseled their way down.
Yep. They call it the alien south because it is truly alien to them.
To them, it kind of is. They use the Shiavi to try to do a lot of that, and they make examples of power and all this, and they've realized that all the great craftsmen of old Mutapa, this is a gold mine of Sekhem. There's a lot of artifacts. There's a lot of things that they want.
Well, it's not that it's a gold mine. It's a lot of material, and surprisingly, despite not having any ties to IRM, yeah, you can definitely find Sekhem here.
They made artifacts. That's why I said it's a gold mine of Sekhem because no one else has been here to exploit it yet.
So they started to do so, teaching them basic craftsman tricks as spirits.
Yeah, they figured out that the locals have this belief. We can use this belief. We're going to do it. We're going to be these Shavi characters in the background and work our way in through there rather than our normal method of doing mummy stuff, which is to infiltrate society with cults. Our cults instead are going to be much, much more subtle here.
Funnily enough, Shanksen, which are the plague mummies, the bane mummies.
They're not very common. Most of the local examples are damaged Arisen and not the original Iremite slaves.
Because, yes, an Arisen that is sufficiently damaged can become one.
Yes. But this also means that it's much easier for them to deal with Bane mummies because they have an idea of who they are. This is starting to change now, though, and it's not changing for the better because guess who else wants Sekhem? Guess who else knows where the Sekhem is? Guess who else is coming there?
Thank you, Portugal.
Thank you, Portugal. The Bane mummies are coming in with the Portuguese because, well, there's a lot more Bane mummies in Europe than there are in Africa.
Quite a bit.
And
yeah.
There's an area here that they also realize we've never heard of this from before.
And
there's a good chance
because they're building
it's
all going to
be filled
artifacts.
With Sekhem. Yeah, we need to go there. And turns out there's also others there. And here you go. New Bane mummies are also, it's also very hard for them to represent it. So this is a problem. Mortals suffer unexplained deaths, accusations of witchcraft, general social unrest. You know, it would have happened without the Shakazin, but it doesn't mean that the Shakazin aren't exploiting the chaos to eat mummies.
Yeah, especially since there are, it's not really among Mutapa, but there's always rumors of cannibal tribes.
Yeah, easy excuse. So the mummies from abroad are usually, they come here, they have like no cult, they're fleeing oftentimes, they're not exactly in a great position, which is kind of a fun thing to look at, where it's like, if you want to play a mummy in the setting that has no connection to the rest of it, is to play like a foreign mummy from like Portugal or wherever else that is coming here because they thought that this place was completely unclaimed, open territory, and then they get here and they're like, ah, fuck, it's just like home.
Let me pull. Let me take off my nightmare glasses. Oh, it's exactly
Oh,
the
it's
same.
exactly the same. So the newcomers can start to build their cults later on, but the sometimes these are the first followers they've ever had are these Portuguese merchants or whatever else as they're setting up
I mean,
as
because you're
Portugal takes over
basically a
parts of
mini
the area.
Cthulhu. What the fuck are you thinking, like, when you see something like that?
Yeah, the. A lot of this kind of goes into the note the notes of like the various guilds of the Arisen. So the mummies pretended to be these, you know, floating spirits in order to influence the artisans to create more artifacts that would give them Scum. So therefore, the ones that are the most successful are the ones that were the metal workers because.
Mesanubi, or in this case, the Societies of
Yes, the
Gold and Iron.
The
because
Mesanebu, yeah.
the guild has a lot of stuff where they look and they may, some of the mummies blame themselves for maybe pushing Great Mutapa too far in we want more metalwork stuff, so mine more gold. We don't care if it collapses your economy, mine more gold. That we are the Shavi, we demand it.
And you would
Gold
listen to the
mine, go
Shavi.
burr.
And you would. So I think it's a fun little bit of like, oh yeah, why did Great Mutapa collapse? Mummies. Why not?
Oh, by the way, the question for how much hate do I hate Thin Bloods? I don't hate the original concept of Thin Bloods. The idea behind them, I can understand why they'd want to tweak it. It's just the way 5th edition handled that by first making them a clan, like a full-on clan. And then giving them a discipline that, let's just f safely say it is absolute fucking horseshit, because the running theme of it is you can do all the other disciplines at a dot lower with the right situations and create sunlight grenades. Oh, and you only take lethal from the sunlight grenades, while they all take aggravated.
Yep.
There's.
Also,
Oh,
one more.
God. But anyway, I don't want to talk about that. I want to talk about the Mahicap.
Maha
Oh,
Cap.
one sec. Also, one more. You can play as a KKK beast in Reconstruction or Beast.
Yeah, you can play Jubal early or Nathan Bedford Forrest. Either one, honestly.
It's just not
Pro
exactly what
pro
I'd call
pro
like.
prove me wrong that both of them were not beasts.
Beast is like, I don't know why they chose the Reconstruction era for it. It would have been much, much better to
Prove
do
me
it for something
wrong.
like.
Prove me wrong that Nathan Bedford Forrest didn't dream deep and became a
They should
monster.
have. You want to know what my hot take is? They should have put them in the French Revolution setting. It would have been perfect for
French
Beast.
Revolution setting would have been very, very well done. They should have done that.
They should have done that, but they had other ideas for that because it's vampire and demon and mummy. That's in Dark
Another
Eras too.
one that potentially could be interesting is 184 the springtime of Europe, 1848.
That would have been another good one. You can do like, don't get me wrong. There, you can do good beast things. You just have
Ooh,
to throw out
I
most
got one.
beast.
I got another one. I think it's called the Narodnik movement. The Narodnik movement, reform movement Russia during the 1870s, with the rise of social revolution. The same people that killed Alexander II.
Oh yeah.
Narodnik Russia. Like, it's a parallel to the demons found early Soviet Russia.
Yes, but basically put, back to the mock cap. So the mock cap are, they're the spies. They're the informants among the Arisen, and they're kind of interesting. They made it so that they could.
So, funnily enough, they actually are not natively part of Mutapa. They went even further north.
Wait, was it the? Sorry, I got that mixed up. It's a different one. That's
They're the amulet
the. I used to.
crafters.
Amulet Crafters, that's it. Sorry.
So
rather
than
somebody else
working in Mutapa, they decided to go to the northern Lake Malawi around the beginnings of the Rift Lakes.
Yeah.
They did not go to the Shona. They went to the Amravi.
Yep, and they got in with all these mask societies for ritual and, objects, because wearing masks is often a part of ritual.
Especially among the Amravi. It is to the Mutapa to a degree, since they wear costumes representing their totem or historic figures, but the Amravi very much were hard into masks.
Yeah.
The consequence of this is that they're largely absent from the formation of the Mutapa Empire. Furthermore, the Amravi are somewhat of a rival to the rival kingdom roughly a century before the Axial Crusade. So
they were not as great in scale, but yeah, they had their own influence and power.
They are outsiders among the outsiders.
Which I think is an interesting touch, by the way. I like that they mention another, because this region of Africa is very, very neglected usually.
Yeah, and then they mention, so the Society of Sculptors is next, and they're kind of fun. The cult, however, had a lot of problems because they decided to, they're the sculpture cult, which means they wanted to be, they need a strong centralized kingdom for stonework and prestige and all this.
And they put all of their eggs in Great Zimbabwe, the Zimbabwean kingdom, the people who built the Zimbabwes.
Yep.
And
it collapsed.
Mainly because of crop. It was mainly due to water failure. If I recall, they went through a massive drought period during that time.
Yeah. In any case, their influence kind of cratered, and it's not exactly the greatest situation for them. But they're hoping for another long, stable dynasty where they can worm their way back into power again.
And it's looking pretty nice, although the Portuguese are making it a bit of concerning.
And it doesn't seem to be like there's a lot of their fellow guildmates from far away that have come back with the Portuguese, so that's kind of nice.
Yeah, it doesn't help that they're kind of clashing with the Mesinebu, who are definitely much more influential than them at this moment.
Yeah. And then there's the Society of Sites, the Shahebsu, which are the inscribers, the scribes. They have a bit of a problem. There's not a lot of writing.
Read? What?
So instead, they kind of...
You left us with nothing!
Yeah. If your art is worthless, is worthy, the people will learn it. By and large, they did not. Basically, they told all the writing nerds, like, no, this is a mistake. Like, I was told I would be writing poetry. Dig the fucking hole!
One of them remembers the agreement to divide power by trade.
And it's like, what the fuck are you doing this to us? And it's like, well, you know, you asked for this.
And on top of that, if your trade is really worth anything, they'll pick it up. No one did.
They did not pick it up. No one did. So they still acted as judges and negotiators, but they're pretty much unconnected from local mortals. They're just Shiavi would occasionally get contacted to be like, hey, we need a legal dispute ruling. And they're like, okay, how many cows were stolen? How many people died? So on and so forth. All right. Everything good? Yay. So then they finally had
people
the traders
who can't
arrive.
Fucking right. They're called the Swahili and then the Portuguese. And for once, they don't feel like they don't regret being immortal.
Right. So they're kind of like, this is pretty great. We've got these new people that are coming in, and if we help them out, we can fuck over everyone else.
Because we were fucked. We have to dig holes.
Yes. Basically, the Society of Wandering Caterpillars is the next, which are the priest caste, the Sumanet. Generally speaking, they have a little bit of an issue, the embalmers here. After burial, some of the beliefs is that the person's soul comes back as a caterpillar, which is kind of baller.
Yeah, it crawls from the earth in the form of one, yep.
And then until it gets called as an ancestor spirit. These are usually ordinary ghosts, but they kind of have this thing where they are talking about this is kind of similar to the Duat. The priests of the shell have established themselves among
But the
undertakers,
problem
but
is, Shona religion believes, yeah, there's no real underworld.
yeah,
There's
also
none.
that burial preparation is done by the family. There's no like external group of people that do it. It's done by the family. It's a family thing. So instead, they decided to recruit from healers and people that would be by the dying because it's close enough.
So one thing, there, the customary position is that no member of the Lost Guild has come south. In
Yeah.
fact, it's taboo to speculate that the deceived might have invaded. However, when the Deathless surveyed the lands of the Zambezi Valley and adjacent lands, they observed a people drenched in poetry, dance, storytelling, and quiet contemplations of nature, all sources of Siba, intangible relics beloved of the Lost Guild, which has led to a
Yes.
rampant paranoia that one arisen or another was secretly serving the enemy. And so they know that the relics are here, yet there's no evidence that any member of the Lost Guild has been here.
Yes, which is one of the things that really is making them freak out a bit. And this is part of why I love the Deceived a lot, is that the Deceived are basically the Artisans Guild. Also somewhat the Magician's one. But the thing with that is that they are the all the arts that are not physical. Their
And the
dance, their
Shona
song,
very
poetry,
much are
writing.
a musical, poetic, ceremonial sort.
Monial
It is
culture.
literally every aspect of the deceived.
Yes. Tradition says, of course, that potentially that there was an arisen that kind of may have had something to do with attacking the Awakened because they thought they were deceived puppets and, just mistakes and the miracles. And by miracles, I mean a lot of people probably fucking died and disasters happened.
You know, I realized this. With the fact that they do not like dancing, I kind of want to run a mummy
Mummy version of
chronicle based on,
Footloose.
yes, based on Footloose.
The best part is they constantly like to kill mages because that's how they do their rituals.
Yeah.
Wait, they brought rain? Deceiver puppet!
Yes. Policy is simple. Kill them.
So you
It's
have a
nice.
bit of a mage and mummy war going on, or at least a low-level vendetta killing.
I
The
fucking
policy is
love
simple.
this. I
Wait, the
genuinely
policy is
fucking love
simple. Also,
this.
this is unique because
Kill
the...
the artist and suppress the art.
Well, no, this is also somewhat unique because guess what? It's one of the few times that they actually had an interaction between the two set in the same thing.
Yes, usually they don't do anything together. They're kind of on a side parallel. No. In this setting, your mummies and your mages are getting involved with each other for various reasons.
The mages are concerned because these are very powerful foreign spirits that seem to be annoyed with some of their ancestor spirits for some reasons. While they're like, no, you're one of their puppets, aren't you? And they're like,
And the
I don't
mummies
what?
are trying to play the long game, and they're thinking, ah, fuck, is this a sign of the people we can't talk about? And there's a lot of paranoia going on.
Because
There's a
every
lot of.
aspect of their society almost makes it perfect for them. It's almost like they were engineered.
Yes. So the lands of the dead, they talk about what are the rules you need to do for this? Because a lot of this stuff involves mediums and ghosts and spirits. So they do a lot of talk about that. It's kind of this is all kind of like details. We can skip down to the story seeds because this is more like mechanical.
Yeah, because this is trying to rationalize how an underworld would work in a society that literally doesn't believe in one.
Also talking about how mage powers will interact with mummies, how mummy powers will interact with mages, all
Which is
these sort of
fair because
things.
they actually are clashing, which is one of the few times
Yes.
I would say that this actually does that.
The
Which
following
I think is to its
scenarios.
benefit. I like that.
Yeah, so then they give you some scenarios. So one of the scenarios is the Road to Great Zimbabwe, where they're talking about the idea is that there's a ranting about a spiral beneath the Great Watchtower. He falls into a coma. There's a explorer, and if he's healed, he wakes with no memory of this labyrinth. But he was part of an expedition that was going there. And yes, this could merge very easily with Sin Eater still, with just a little bit of work, which is you could have a three-way war between the mages who the Sin Eaters don't like, the mummies who the Sin Eaters also don't like, and then so on and so forth, because they're the wrong kind of medium. Because, no, they're not talking with the ancestors. I'm the one that's talking with the ancestors, because if I have an ancestor in my goddamn head.
So the player characters are interested explorers seeking to unravel the mystery of the Great Zimbabwe. Because Zimbabwe is the term for stone structures. Great Zimbabwe is huge.
Yes. So there's a couple of thoughts about this. If they're mages, this could be a thing of, like, this isn't Atlantean, and we don't know what it's guarding. We need to figure out what it is.
It's not of Atlantean origin, but it might have been an attempt to almost recreate a lesser version.
And if it's mummies, it's sort of like, oh no.
Is this where the deceive came from?
More like, oh no, I think we did this.
It's either, did the deceive do it? Or actually, since you have stonecrafters, the stonecrafters go, oh no, the thing we built, the thing we had them built, it's doing something we didn't intend.
So basically, they
this
go
is
to,
not to not.
The bottom of it, they find they're not the first arrival, and it's just a story seed. It's not like a full thing. So whatever's at the bottom, you can come up with. Yeah.
And that's what I like about, it's both, I like and dislike. It's not a full adventure splat, so you can't really, if you're not experienced with DMing, do anything, but this is like, here's stuff you can turn into a chronicle.
The next one is, of course, about the accidental crusade, where,
because
congratulations,
you need
with
one.
It. You're on it. Have fun.
Yeah?
Oh, no.
You're probably members of the Accidental Crusade.
Oh, no.
Some might be Wenem to Mutapa, who got caught up and have to be stayed alive. Yeah, it's a nightmare. It is a nightmare.
They grab the local... they're like, the local magicians should know the way, the priests say, like the Jesuits, and they're like, yes, and then now you're having to try to trick these fucking foreigners that have abducted you into thinking that you are really the magic man, without being too obviously much of a magic man, because they have a thing about witches, apparently.
No. So, they say that... the characters could have ended up in a naturally occurring spatial temporal anomaly.
That's also true. You could draw in
some
of that,
any other place on Earth. Oh shit! Time traveling Portuguese.
You could, unironically,
Portuguese.
The spiral in Great Zimbabwe. You could actually have You could actually have your characters stumble out of it, and you have like a bunch of like Nigel Thornberry-esque motherfuckers doing.
Yeah, I mean, you could also use that as like a. I mean, with the labyrinth thing, you could also bring it into like God Machine infrastructure. There's a lot of really neat hooks you can take out of that. The next one is the Ghost Maker, which is something killed the population of a town, and then it happens again. But the ghosts know the truth, and so on and so forth. Kind of a weak one, but it's really short. It's just a really simple one. Next one I find is kind of interesting.
Yes, the legends. I love this.
The Mines of King Solomon.
Because, again, the reason the Portuguese even did this is because, well, what they remember, they took a port city, they took one port city and took another, and they did this because they found out it was a gold hub. They then found out it comes from even deeper, and there was always rumors that King Solomon got his mines from the deepest parts of Africa, got his gold and diamonds and gems from Africa.
Because, you know, his baby mama, Queen Sheba, you know, all that.
They don't know where. And this is looking like a good candidate because there's a lot of gold and a lot of ivory coming out of here.
Yes. Now, here's one of the things that I like about this is that they give you three really good resolutions. The mystery of the mines is actually not one. There was once some powerful alchemists. And it's more of a mystery of what happened to those alchemists that you're trying to dig into, and you can do a lot of things with that. The next one is, the mines are actually a real place. Now you really can't get there, but to get into it, and you might be able to get a bunch of treasure. Now, how do you get the treasure out? That's kind of fun. And
or
the last one is more
metaphorical.
A metaphorical treasure, like metaphysical stuff where like the mines are not actually real, but their wisdom basically is real. So the things that you're searching for is literally the knowledge of lost ancestors, lost Atlantis, treasures from IRM itself, as well, possibly like
or,
knowledge
or
of
could
IRM itself.
Literally be the journey, like
yes.
Because that's a very common thing in
yeah the real treasure is the friends you made along the way.
Well, it's not the friends you made along the way; it's the wisdom that you've gained as you continue onward. Like
you know what I mean about
yourself.
You know what I mean, though, with that. Then they go in across, like, the Chronicles of Darkness.
So let's like the see. Shona much as ghosts, really Poetia, blah, blah, blah. As far as they're concerned, the Shona disregard the fine classification. Any given occult entity is either Shavi, which is the foreign spirits, or a Varoyi, or witch, if not.
So on one hand, very detailed stuff about like their culture is like they have a lot of definitions of like the types of spirits
and the level of power like, that they have or what they're tied to.
No, it's either a friendly one or it's not. And which if I think it's not, it's a witch. Which is fun.
Unironically, here's a fun one. You could be a sin eater and you're like, okay, we're going to consult a Shavi, and you find out like you're a bit scared because you think it might be you ran into this weird Cthulhu thing that talks about pillars and shit. And you're like, oh no, I don't want to run into that again. That almost killed
everyone. Oh, it's just a normal spirit. Yeah.
No, it's just a normal spirit. And then you find out, no, it's actually a fucking vampire just chilling.
Yeah. You can definitely do that.
Quite a few vampires don't usually go the Shavi route. Most of the time they go for the Varoyi route, though.
Yeah.
And they also suggest that you can make some interesting bloodlines for this area, too.
Yes, which I think is kind of neat. It's an idea. It's a way to display how the blood is mutable of your kindred. So have them have like create a new bloodline where it's like their legs are literally backwards now, or whatever else.
So werewolves actually, when they came down to this region as they expanded outward for the hunts for spirits, they experienced a big problem. Mutapa doesn't have wolves.
Yeah, it doesn't.
So they had to figure out what the hell are we gonna do. And the very common one is
they pretended to be mediums. They developed new gifts from the spirit world to allow themselves to disguise as jackals or hyenas.
As for changelings and beasts, they don't have their own culture beneath. They just
keep themselves as similar to Shona beliefs. It's like, changelings often think that they ended up with like a bunch of witches, and that's why everything's fucked up. And beasts are like, well, we are witches. We're just going to have fun.
Which good for them. Demons and Shona are very fun. Unironically, a demon campaign in Great Mutapa is a very fun idea. Or during Zimbabwe.
Yeah,
like you could literally have a chronicle just being you're trying to force Great Zimbabwe to fall because the architecture, like, it's leaking something. You don't necessarily know if it's that weird, if it's weird mummy shit, or if it is god machines working through mummy hands, because that has happened at least on one occasion. You don't know. Yep. You could actually have a demon chronicle being, oh yeah, we're crashing Great Zimbabwe, no survivors.
Yeah. The next one is Prometheans, which is kind of fun. Mutapa demons associate Mawari with the god machine, and therefore are able to use some of that. But I like the Promethean one a lot more.
Yep.
They believe that their nearly human state in the Earth Fire comes from Mawari as a punishment for their creator. Basically, they view their creator as witches, and they need to figure out a way to become real people.
Mm-hmm. As for the Kashmalim, they are spirits.
Yep, it's simple, but you could definitely do something interesting with that.
And as for what did they use for their material, because as Squirrel Killer mentioned, talking about Great Mutapa, especially, I mean, in the time period they wrote this, which was in the 2010s, it was a hell of a lot easier than if they tried to do this in the 1990s.
Yeah. Oh God, I am trying to imagine.
It would have been so accidentally offensive, but like genuinely trying, it would have been touching, I think. So the ones that they mostly used are Guns and Rain.
The inspirational material is actually pretty good. Guns and Rain, Gorillas in Spirit Mediums in Zimbabwe, exploring how the Shona beliefs were involved with the anti-colonial attitudes of various rebel groups. Yep.
Which it did. In fact, there was a movement to try to kind of rebound and create a new Shona, but it didn't go through.
Yeah, early Portuguese imperialism,
using Jesuits in the Mutapa Empire of Zimbabwe, International Journal of Peace Development Studies, Volume 2, 4, pages 132 to 137, April 2000.
Again, there's a paucity of sources sometimes.
Yeah.
Which is about the Accidental Crusade. Pretty much most of it's just a lot of academic texts.
Popular politics.
Interesting, they do. They bring up King's Helen's Mines and Other Quartermain Novels by H.
H.
Rider
Rider Haggard, along with are with modernized, extremely imperialistic and racist, but he knew how to write a good story. They're like, go ahead and read them if you're looking for like more of a swashbuckling adventure.
I unironically, I like how they had to throw in that little jab. That I think that's a little sad, but I mean, at the end of the day, they also didn't say when it was written. So you might want to warn them ahead of time that this was written in the fucking 20th century or 19th century.
Let me look this up. I'm betting this is in the 1800s.
Late, it's at least framed in that time period.
H. Rider Haggard died in 1925.
So very likely 1890s.
Oh, and also South African. So yeah, here we go.
So you have to give a heads up that yes, this is written
quarter.
This is written in
Tarzan's
timeland.
Quartermain and King Solomon's Mines. That was 1885.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
Are you surprised?
No, I am not surprised at all. If that's going to be, it's going to be kind of pretty racist.
It's 1890s. Like this is contemporary. This is a little bit older than Tarzan, dude.
That said, he does have heroic Africans in his novels. He does have some sympathy to them.
He actually was at least not completely garbage with them.
He was not completely racist, just very much the English sort of racist, which is that if you adopted my beliefs, you would be perfect people.
Yes. That happened a lot. And the last one is a political history of Munhu Mutapa, which, let's be fair, it's difficult to find, it's critical. If you're going to do research on it, this is like one of the first books you go to.
You're going to have to go to a university library and see if you can find it.
It literally is your go-to. You kind of, like, if you're going to do research on it, this is where you start.
Yeah.
So the one after this one, just to give a little looky, we're not going, like, this isn't going to be in order. I'm just going to show it off. The Four Horsemen, which... When the Horseman Rhodes is specifically the 30 Years' War, that's a fun one.
And it, of course, opens with a quote from Revelations.
Which is not unsurprising.
Like, what a surprise.
Authority was given to them over a fourth of the earth to kill with sword and with famine and with pestilence and the wild beasts of the earth. Because that's the 30 Years' War in a nutshell.
Yeah, the 30 Years' War is a fantastic conflict and an example of the founding of nation states in modern Europe. It's also one of the most destructive conflicts of all time.
It wiped out, I believe, 10 to 20% of the German people by the end of it.
Yeah, it killed about 10 to 20% of the people and displaced another probably 10%. It was pretty fucking bad. And you have to understand that this is a place of, like, millions of people. Early modern Europe is a relatively densely populated area. It isn't as dense as China, but nothing is. But it's still pretty densely populated.
So overall, my thoughts on the Mutapa Chronicles, I actually rate this as a very high good.
Or very
close to amazing, and here's why. Part of it is recency bias. Let's be fair. I tend to be kinder to the things I just experienced. But what I really liked is the interdynamics between mages and mummies. They actually played with it. Most chronicles, most Dark Era chronicles don't do that.
Well, we did have that talk with vampire and changeling in the Elizabethan era of how the changelings were reliant on the vampires.
Yeah, but that was to the detriment of, I believe it was the detriment of the changelings.
It kind of was. It was interesting.
We had to use Count Motherfucking Dracula to prop that one up.
Yeah, the section on the changelings was not very long. That was the main issue with it. This is also not very long for either one, but I think that's just because it's
I would say the mummies got the shorter end of the stick, but they did really well with what they had.
Yes, it definitely gives you an idea of why would you want to play this? And they give you a bunch of reasons for why you would want to. There's a lot of interesting things going on in the era and in the area, and you can play with those. It doesn't necessarily... I wouldn't say that this calls to me of, like, I must run this immediately sort of feeling, but it's definitely if I had to make a one-shot, this wouldn't be a bad place to do it.
Yeah, actually, I'm going to have to knock it down to just merely good, and here's why. It's an interesting setting, but good luck trying to get people interested in it.
or willing to play it. It's the issue with the New Zealand setting all over again. No.
This has a little more ties because then you can kind of do an interesting little chronicle where after you deal and play around in Mutapa as the Portuguese, you can then kind of continue your Cold War with the Ottomans.
Yeah.
If you play it from the point of view of Portuguese, you can kind of, you can start here and then continue by doing a chronicle among India, among Goa, or into the Akhe Sultanate.
Is that you're going to have to do some research to get it accurate?
Not in Mutapa, because they did a pretty good job of giving
you
the basics.
And I think that's the most important thing of a setting like this, where it's like, you need to have the basics. If you get the basics right, the rest of it's just flavor for a lot of people.
Mm-hmm. And I would say it's slightly less of an issue than New Zealand, because you can kind of go on from there. One of the things I have to say, though, I have to give a lot of credit and applause. It actually covered a different take on interpreting Mage that was both interesting and also did an excellent job at not being up its ass. You have to give that a lot of credit. It is complex enough, especially since we skimmed through because they talked a bit about cosmology and how they interact with each other. But it doesn't overstay its welcome. It's a solid setting. Maybe not the most interesting, but it's a good source to at least make a different tradition set for Mage. Like, do you want to play around with like the Exarchs and Atlantis? You don't have to. This shows that you don't have to with an Awakening.
You can just strip it out. You can strip it out. It doesn't necessarily need to matter. There's things that do matter about it, and they do mention that like the Seers of the Throne would be an issue because their beliefs are contrary to yours here in this location. How you can strip out a lot of the stuff about Atlantis, and they're still dicks because they still are undermining you, and they believe in some weird things outside time. There you go. That's all. You don't have to get into your Atlantis bullshit. If they believe in the Atlantis bullshit, that's fine. That makes them weird and spookier. You know.
And on top of that, like I said, since it's not as isolated as New Zealand was in the 50s, you can then kind of, if you're getting tired of Mutapa, you can go further outward, either as an awakened or an arisen. Or alternatively, you could be a bunch of vampires doing a grift. Pretending to be witches in Mutapa.
Yes, I'm a witch. Look at me. I can turn my face into something else because I'm a gangrel with protean too.
Or you could be a bunch of sin eaters from the accidental crusade. You died during
You got up and you're like, fuck. Like I've got some pagan spirit inside of my soul now. Shit.
Yeah. Hello. I'm not the one criticizing your
Father
beliefs.
Father Zhao is going to be very mad at me.
Hello. I'm the man that you killed about an hour ago in that previous battle. I'm not the one making fun of your beliefs. Like I said, there's enough accessibility. Like, it's not completely isolated from the world. It is to its detriment, since it is a region people are going to be like, really? Why do that when we can play Russian Revolution Demon, where we can actually be part of the politics?
Yeah, we can get purged by Stalin. It'll be a lot of fun.
Yeah, I mean, no. Many of our identities get purged by Stalin. We just keep making new ones, and it's a race to see who dies first. No, it's a race to see who gives up first. Stalin's chopping hand or our ability to make up identities.
The idea of playing a demon game in Russia, in like Soviet Russia, with like...
And you play it like a game of paranoia. Yeah, you play it
it's just like paranoia. That sounds really fun. It's just the death of Stalin, the movie, the game.
Like who's going to get out of this first? Is Stalin's chopping hand going to start missing you guys quickly enough, or are all of your covers going to get blown and you're going to just be destroyed or dissected by the Soviet medical community?
Yeah, like that could be a lot of fun. But yeah, there's a lot of stuff in Dark Heroes Companions. It is definitely a shorter book than the original,
which is both to its benefit and to its detriment to a degree.
It is.
I will say, out of the table of contents, the only one that really doesn't appeal because of how it gets handled is the Fearful Lesson, which is the beast one.
Yeah, all of these are relatively solid settings. I have some quibbles with some of them.
I will say that the 30 Years War one, it's literally just adventure hooks, which is a very interesting take.
It's a huge conflict. It's really hard to sum up 30 years of a very complicated, very messy political conflict in 30 pages.
So, yeah, they just kind of went with a bunch of adventure hooks.
All you're going to say is people fought and people died. That's about it.
Yeah, but the reasoning why and the shit that went down before and during the 30 Years' War is absolutely insane. I think that was contemporary said it was like the world gone mad.
It just started as, if I remember, didn't it just start as a single knight killed a priest who was given his lands and he wanted them back?
No, it's more complicated than that. The real thing that kicks it off is that there's stuff like that going on.
Oh no, I was confusing that with the wars of religion. Literally, one of the starting flashpoints was
French ones. Yeah, the thing that kicks off the 30 Years' War is the defenestration of Prague, because there's an issue with the imperial succession over the throne of Bohemia, where the Bohemians at this point are mostly Protestant of various flavors, and they do not want the Habsburgs to have the throne. They elect a different person as their king, but the Habsburgs insist on having it, and then their representative gets thrown out a window. So, you know, that's like simplified. I probably got like at least two things in that statement wrong. Again, it's a complicated subject. But basically, a bunch of guys getting thrown out of a window, and I don't think any of them actually died from that, if I'm remembering
none
correctly.
None of them did. In the Catholic version, it was considered a blessing that a bale of hay, or at least enough hay,
that they didn't all die. Yeah, basically.
The Protestant take is, yeah, there was so much horseshit there that
shit.
They,
yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
But,
point being is that
like
sparked a rebellion in Prague, which led to a bunch of other
stuff.
Some
people fought, some people died.
Yeah.
That's like, about it.
It's
complicated.
It's complicated.
I'll just say that, like I said, Mutapa, I was rating it high good, but yeah, in retrospect, solid good. The big negatives are you have to have people willing to stick it out in that area for at least a little bit. If you do get tired of it, at the very least, you can play around, because they do talk about the Portuguese-Ottoman War, so you can kind of continue from there.
It's an interesting region, at the very least.
Yeah, it's like, an interesting region. I like how they handle mages. They did it in a good way. The mummies having a grift economy sounds amazing. So, you know, I'd say overall a solid setting. I don't know how it would stack with the original Dark Eras books we covered. I will say it's at least a hell of a lot better than Brian Boru's Wild Ride. I'm never going to forgive that pile of shit for existing.
It gave us the best art in the book of the very confused man with the werewolf next to him.
I am never forgiving Brian Boru dying in one shitty fucking battle in some shithole town in Ireland. All of the Viking history in the world, and you focused on this piece of shit. God damn it. I think I hate that more. No, here's the thing. I think I actually hate that more than the fucking Thin Blood Clan, which is saying a lot.
Really?
Well, think about it like this. The Thin Bloods were never that good. They had a couple of very minor advantages. And then they were given a lot of infinite horseshit, but at the core of it, it was with the idea to improve it, you know?
Okay, but...
This would be like... Okay, so we have cheap, shitty ramen that is stale, and we're trying to make it better by boiling it in hot sauce, and oh no, we kind of fucked up. Right? Like, you're trying to take something garbage and make it better. With Viking era, this would be like taking a beautiful, delectable cut of the highest quality pork belly and then fucking microwaving it after covering it in Sweet Baby Ray's bootleg.
Okay.
At least the latter is edible.
On that note, I think we've had all of the statements we can make about this setting, which
definitely.
It's good. It's worth reading. We don't know if you'll ever be able to run it or play in it, but it's neat.
I will say you can get a copy of the companion books. I usually link to DriveThruRPG just because it's kind of the locus point for you where you get all of this. If you don't necessarily get it for Mutapa, there are enough interesting settings that I think you would genuinely like. The Russian Revolution Demon one is one of them. So there is at least more than enough scenarios that you probably would get mileage out of. I do recommend it because of that. Feel free to like/subscribe/join Discord. That's also in the description link. As for what we're going to cover next week, I'm open to suggestions, honestly.
Why don't people leave it in the comments?
Yeah, feel free. Suggest ideas in the comments. That.
Like, we've got a list of books we can cover. We probably at some point need to do our Glorantham lore ramblings where we go on about how Greg Stafford did a lot of cocaine in the 70s and wanted to fuck hippie chicks. But there's a few other settings where we wanted to go into, like, deep dives on that.
God, the cosmology of Glorantha could literally be a 12-hour long video, and you still wouldn't
It would be a 12-hour long video. That's the problem. I was talking more like the other things we could do, which is to go into the absolute insanity that was early... something like Dragonlance or just, oh God.
The problem is that relies on, I've never read any of those Salvador Dali or whatever, Salvador Dali also wrote for Dragonlance. Yeah, it was the last thing he wrote before he died.
He actually wrote it.
Salvador Dali actually wrote the first Dragonlance book in the same book loaner club library that the fake assassin Lee Harvey Oswald was. Well, the real assassin Oswald Mosley was on the grassy knoll. Like, he actually was writing the first copy of Dragonlance in the book tower.
Okay.
The Adam Mushmouth's conspiracy universe has gained a new member today.
Oswald fucking Mosley? Seriously?
No, you don't remember the Oswald Mosley conspiracy? That's like one of our first Dice Gums.
I don't remember that one. It's been so long ago.
It's because I mushmouthed Lee Harvey Oswald. I was like, Oswald Mosley. Yeah, he's the one.
He's the guy who killed JFK.
In his turtleneck, yes.
In his turtleneck to establish direct rule from London in an alternate universe where the German Empire won World War I.
So now we know that Salvador Dali in this alternate universe wrote Dragonlance in between making abstract art.
Was Salvador Dali even alive in the 1980s?
No, he was dead. He was dead. I forgot it was Salvatore. I was like, Salvador Dali.
Well, on that note, good night, everyone.
Good night, everyone.
Night, y'all.